I'm gonna wipe you out.
I wanna see you in a bathing suit.
I'd like to see you in New York.
Welcome, one welcome. Oh boy, what just?
I don't know what.
Aabra just made a noise as of.
I don't hear.
Let's count. Like count. Let's all count down. Like 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 or something.
Okay.
You don't hear me?
I don't hear her.
You don't hear her at all?
No.
Oh great.
You unplugged it. That's
okay.
All
right. I hear you.
All right. All right. I hear you.
All right. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. Welcome in, welcome all. We're back here once again. Yes, that was the Beach Boys, or was it? Was it a little fat for you?
It was the Beach Boys meets the Fat Boys, the classic cover of Wipeout.
You told me the Beach Boys did not write Wipeout.
They did not write Wipeout.
Which I was convinced they did write Wipeout.
No. I actually like Wipeout, and I despise the Beach Boys.
You're a surf rock guy, though.
I do like surf rock, and I hate the Beach Boys.
Go figure. Don't you like kind of the trippier, wet drip, you know, effect kind of surf rock, and not Beach Boys, which is I don't know. Boomer
the
rock
harmonies. No, thank you.
Okay. Pet Sounds is the greatest album of all time, though.
so they tell me. Yeah.
Brian Wilson, genius.
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 Griff, it is. Somebody told me this. It's Pride Month. It's the end of Pride Month. And this is the time of year where every corporation panders to gay people in order to get money from them.
That's right.
And we're not above pandering. So we decided we already did Cruising, the greatest gay movie of all time.
A wonderful gay movie.
But this is the second greatest gay movie of all time.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I was going to
play devil's advocate and like fight the fight. This isn't a gay movie, but no, this is a super gay movie.
Yeah.
And when we ever talk about gay movies, who do we think of immediately? Whenever we think movies that show men's butts constantly, who do we think of?
I think West of the Mississippi for sure.
Of course.
I think West of Nevada for sure. I think our only friend.
My only female friend. Which, by the way, means I'm not a misogynist, people. So, like, if people are like, Tim, you hate women. No, I don't. I have one female friend. You know, where you're, and by the way, up until now, she's been in the minor leagues, but now she's earned her way up in the tippy taps.
Holy shit. This is her first movie.
This is her first movie.
Jesus.
So she's finally graduated to the big boy league.
All right.
This is a sprint. This is a marathon. I don't know if she can do it.
This is not just going to be any old movie, though. This is going to feel like a tippy tap because we read her notes. We're unpacking a lot more.
Yeah,
if you're
a big fan of this woman, you're gonna learn a lot about her, because we have questions.
There's so many questions.
So without further ado, it's everybody's favorite female friend, Miss Aabra Kadabra. How the hell are you, girl?
I am great. I am ready for you guys to pop my cherry, my first movie cherry. I'm so excited. Dumbest movie ever made.
Dumbest movie ever made. Well, there's a lot of contests for that. I like that you ignored the point in your notes. We talked about it last week on Kickboxer, because we had a certain director of Kickboxer 3 who wrote this movie.
Oh, I missed that.
Rick King.
Oh, that idiot.
The director of Kickboxers. Holy fuck, how did he... But you know what's interesting between the two is there's kind of a bro connection there. Sasha Mitchell plays a bro constantly, and we have surfers in this movie. So it all kind of works out.
And then was there a punch-up by James Cameron?
Yeah, James Cameron is famous for his, they call them like scriptments, these 45-page rambling, somewhere between a treatment, somewhere between a script. The man is just a creative machine, and he rewrote this, you know, I'm assuming just terrible script by these guys behind apparently one of the Kickboxers, Varsity Blues, and look it up, because you will never believe me, this film exists, Prayer of the Roller Boys, a sci-fi dystopia starring Corey Haim.
That sounds like a knockoff of Rollerball.
Yeah.
So I'd watch that.
Yeah, I would watch the hell out of that.
Is that well, similar to Roller Babies, the other post-apocalyptic movie about roller skating?
I want to fake you out and pretend I know about Roller Babies, but I don't because
I might be making that up, but I think it's called Roller Babies.
Yeah. I am excited to be here. I'm excited for my first film. I'm going to try to stay on topic. I am sober, which for me is a disturbing sensation.
Well, you're riding high on that apple that you're eating a moment ago.
We'll see how long it lasts.
We all know about the effect of nature. You know, it has great effects when you train in nature. I believe when you eat nature, it also has the same effect. So I think you'll be riding high.
I just eat processed foods while I'm doing this.
Right.
Show
and, that's right. Murray's always
suck. But that's what the commitment Aabra has to us. She just got into town to Portland, Oregon.
That's right.
Mere minutes ago. What happened, Aabra?
After watching Point Blank with Mattford, our guest.
You had to go surfing? Is that it?
Yeah, and we were just gobsmacked. Like, the film just washed over my brain, and I realized I'm not taking notes. I'm just sort of in a haze. So I contacted my old buddy, Carrie, who I made sure it was cool to use her name on the air because she's an important person. And I was like, babe, we need to watch this. And she's like, come on down. I've got snacks. Bring donuts. And we did a pajama party this morning on her huge couch. It's just like she made the mistake showing this couch. You know, vampires, you shouldn't invite them in. You know that rule? She could have never showed me this couch because this couch is just fantastic. So it's like I'll be over at her house like tomorrow again. And we watched Point Break again. And she had great notes that I'm going to share with you and some insights into younger viewers because she has teen children. We will get to those.
That's
from Carrie. Thank you.
YouTube content we need.
Yes.
Her children can tell us where Point Break, the reboot went wrong.
Yeah.
So her son, Bobby, goes, who the hell's coming over? And she's like, language. My friend's coming over and we're going to watch Point Break. And like, why? Why would you watch the new Point Break? And she's like, okay, first of all, I didn't know there was a new Point Break. And she goes, no, it's the classic. And he goes, where's the quote here? The old one still has the she said the old one still has a seal of approval from teen boys because he had the point. Oh yeah, that movie, that's all right. So there you go. This film, that's a classic.
All right.
Yeah.
That's a lot coming from is he a millennial or is that are we out
I
to
think
the next?
I think he'd be a zoomer. He's like 16. So
yeah, zoomers, millennial. Aren't they the same? I think they're the same.
Yeah. So seal of approval. Point Break still reaches the young bras.
Number one. It's that dumbed down language. It works on every level. I love it. I'm glad you brought up vampires, though, because I do have questions before we get into actual Point Break.
Right.
So okay. I'm a baby of the 80s. I was born in 87. And so when I was growing up, Jim Carrey was the first actor I clung to.
You know where I thought you were going with this? But
please tell me.
Because the director of this movie, Catherine Bigelow, directed your favorite vampire movie of all time. Near Dark.
No, I did not know that, and I hate it now. So I was watching a nice movie on Mike's Necropoflix last night, and it happened to star one Jim Carrey, because I just needed a dumb movie to put on while I was doing laundry. Once Bitten. And there is a scene in this movie I need to ask you guys about, because I am nowhere near an age where this would have ever existed. Okay. They go to Hollywood. They're teen boys.
Yeah.
And of course, if you're a teen boy, 18, you have to have sex or you're the worst human being alive.
Yeah.
Of course. So they go down to Hollywood. They're trying to get laid. They go to a happening bar.
Wait, is Jim Carrey playing an 18-year-old in
this
movie?
Yes. Okay. It was, I believe, 1985, I think, is when this movie came out. And so he's in there. He hasn't quite mastered all of his facial impressions. He does a De Niro that it was like, what the fuck was that? Like, it was offensively bad. But the point we're getting to here, because we need to keep something short in this episode, they go to this restaurant bar hookup place. And I was like, oh, is this like speed dating? Because there's numbered lights on each table. And then there is a lip phone, very much out of Rocky Horror Show. Isn't that right? Doesn't they have a lip phone in Rocky Horror Show? Or did I make that up?
I think it's Batman.
Oh, that's Batman? Okay, yeah. Anyways. So every table has a number and a phone. And so what you do is you call up the other tables and say, hey, babe, want to come over here and have a drink with some macho men?
So that was like the original internet type dating
situation. I guess.
Situation.
Yes, it's from, it was in Berlin in the 30s. It was a novelty. And yes, it's exactly what you think. It was a hookup. It was a way you called the other table to flirt.
That was actually a thing, though.
Mm-hmm. I've never heard of that, but.
But you've never seen it.
I've never seen it. No, I haven't.
Aubrey, you've never seen it either?
I've seen it in a production of Cabaret. I didn't just pull that story out of my butt. So.
Oh, no, no. I was curious if you guys have ever known or witnessed it personally.
No.
I mean, 11 in 85.
Yeah. I knew you were too young, but still, I was like, you guys have a better chance than I do of receiving this. And
maybe we need to bring it back.
I thought the concept was
like, okay, real fast before we move on, I'd like to point out for the listeners that we all just negotiated how long this episode would go, and now we have the co-host going on a side quest, so that's amusing to me. I've already forgotten what point I was going to make.
That's all right.
That's the perfect episode already. You just grift yourself right out of the talking spot.
We're gonna be here for 3 days. Okay.
We are. I need to hear this story. First of all, do you have something to tell? You're disappointed in Griff. A certain movie that he's never experienced that you think he should have.
That was the second thing I was going to say. Yes, I never had to date because I was Gen X and we just slept with everybody while worrying about AIDS. So I don't know how to tell Griffey that we were just fucking nonstop and like, oh no, what about AIDS? But in high school, I was part of a group that would regularly go to Rocky Horror Picture Show. It was kind of part of our theater gay thing, and I'm shocked to hear Griffey's never seen it.
Yeah, I have dated multiple ladies who got me into some. Is it a musical at all? It is a musical.
It's a musical.
I'm sorry. So it's like I've seen quite a lot of the movie productions, at least the musicals. Like I dated someone who woke up every morning and watched the 300 guy.
Gerard Butler?
Gerard Butler was in Phantom of the Opera, like one of the movie productions.
Oh.
For good Lord.
40 straight days, I woke up to that movie. And then Hedwig and the Angry Inch. Oh, boy. So it's like I've gone through some of the movie experiences, but what I want when Murray was like, hey, you really upset Aubrey. You really got to work on this.
The hate she spewed. I'm like, hey, yeah. I'm just the messenger. Don't give it to me.
So what I need to know is, do I just watch the movie with Tim Curry and everything, or do I go have a real experience, at least in the theater?
Yeah, it only works as a midnight movie. It was a terrible bomb. It's actually in 1001 Films to See Before You Die, if you care about that sort of thing, along with Top Gun, by the way. And... Ooh. They make a case for that it flops. It becomes a midnight movie in like Berlin or somewhere like that, or Munich. And that's where you really need to experience it.
Munich. Okay.
You have to go to Munich. I mean, you want to go to Munich.
Now, what character you have to dress up as a character. What character should Griff be?
Well, yeah, since he's going to have his virgin cherry pop that night. So I would stick to Brad or something really basic. Although, maybe a riffraff. I think you could do a riffraff.
You could pull off a riffraff.
Riffraff.
Griff's a skinny dude.
He's got a skullet.
Right?
Yeah.
Can he wear a hunch? Could you imagine him in a humpback?
I could. Yes.
I can imagine myself in a humpback. I like it.
So that's what you're gonna. All right. So
just put it on your list, your bucket list.
I say you start out Brad, and then when you get comfortable, because you're gonna become a Rocky Horror fanatic. I believe.
Oh, okay. I like it.
You'll be every weekend.
All right.
Yeah, I mean, if you got the pins for it, go for Frankenfurter, but, you know.
I don't think I do. I don't think I have the pins for that one. Since we got close and personal on me, I need to know, because as reading through these notes, you know, we're learning a lot about Aabra as well, and I learned that you used to belong to the pizza business, and I need to know more about this. Tell us something of the inside of the pizza business world, because Michigan is the capital of pizza, by the way.
That's true.
That's actually impressive. You guys have formed a lot of pizza, especially pizza delivery. It's impressive. Now, I was part of a really proud little crew at a place called Roundtable Pizza. I don't know if you guys have that out there. Yeah. And it's a notoriously expensive, slow, very poorly run franchise that still is around somehow. And our owner basically inherited some money and bought it arbitrarily and was like the worst manager on earth. So we basically ran the place ourselves. And I really liked that job, actually.
How old were you when you were doing that?
Oh, I was—I did 3 years of food service, 2 miserable years at a McDonald's, and then 1 at the pizza place. So I was like 17 through 19.
Okay.
Until I got into it. Yeah, it's your typical, you know, you're smart enough to go to college, but your parents aren't going to help you with anything. So food service.
Yeah, I worked at old folks' home doing dietary technician is my title.
Oh, wow.
I gave people soup and salads.
In a technical way.
Though. In a very technical way. I threw creamers at the wall sometimes.
I smell a coming-of-age movie based on Aubrey's pizza experience.
I really... But yeah, was it fresh dough? Did you have to do the tossing and everything?
Well, that's a sad thing. Roundtable Pizza is really good pizza. We used fresh ingredients. We had this great salad bar. Yeah, we made the dough every day. We had this crazy dough guy who had blown his knee out in high school sports, which greatly disturbed me. And you could hear him clicking as he came towards you.
What's his name? Johnny
click.
Utah.
Yeah, and it was very click, 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 click. It's like, oh, the dough started. Good. You know? And almost all of us were either high or altered because we had a wine spigots, and the owners did not know how to do inventory, but we did.
Oh, you crazy kids.
Yeah. Walk so Party Down, Party Down is basically a doco for me. If you ever watch Party Down. Yes.
I have seen most of Party Down. Yeah. That is a very entertaining show.
Yeah, we were naughty little imps robbing the place blind, but we did make good pizza.
Well, at least you had some kind of, you know, pride in your work, even if you were a little tipsy.
And then the owner would hire Christians because he was convinced they were better workers. And then the manager, she would hire ex-strippers because she was convinced they were good workers. And you won't be shocked to hear they did not get along.
Deflowering of Christians or anything?
That happened a couple times and got a little ugly. I get this one guy, he had a purity ring, and then he wasn't wearing the purity ring, and everyone started teasing him. Hey, Henry, where'd your purity ring go? And we all knew where that purity ring went.
This is a tippy tap on its own. We're going to have to bookmark this one and come back to it later.
We haven't even got to Bean Dad yet.
We haven't even got to the shredded cheese blend you use. So we'll get to that. We got to talk about this movie, Murray. We're already 20 minutes.
So I got to hear about Bean Dad first.
Okay, real fast. I've tempted the audience too long. So yes, I have. I go to a lot of rock concerts, a lot of concerts with my husband. He's a huge music guy. He was briefly up for a DJ spot in Eugene, Oregon. It didn't work out, but yes, he is a prog dude. It was going to be a prog show. You guys guessed right. The point is, we go to a lot of shows. And
I asked the question, and I want to know the answer real quick. Is he a fan of prog Genesis?
My husband can tell you stories about Peter Gabriel and that damn dress and the damn fox mask. I mean, if you want me to bring him on the air.
I will happily talk to Matt Furt about dress and that Fox Max.
Yeah, that will be a side quest. But because I'm 5'3", 5'4", whatever I'm listed as, I'm very short. And my father was 6'3", 6'4", and he politely called me Napoleon because I have a little bit of a short person problem. And I go to shows, and it tends to get kind of exacerbated. Like I was recently at a Titus Andronicus show with 7-foot moose people.
We were talking about that last week with the wrestling show.
Right. Yeah, I totally sympathize with you guys. I was like, oh! And yeah, like I was at a Pixie show and the girls in front of me were dancing and their hair is just in front of me and in my face and oopsie, I'm pulling their hair. And Matt said, quote unquote, a cat fight broke out.
What? Wow. You pulled hair?
I just, something in me, when people block my view, I get kind of, one of my husband's charming nicknames for me is She-Hulk. So But yeah, we're at Barbati's Pan, which is one of my favorite venues. I've seen Red Elvis is there, and oh God, who else? Just a great show. Malcolmus or somebody? And anyway, it's Silver Jews, and their opening act is Long Winters, which you guys know as Harvey Danger. Oh, is their other band? Flagpole Sitta.
Flagpole
Sitta. Yes, that's right.
Yes. Well, Portland doesn't like Seattle, and Seattle doesn't understand why we don't like them. So whenever a Seattle band comes to Portland, we sort of get kind of mean. And Bean Dad, he wasn't Bean Dad at the time. He was just the lead singer of Harvey Danger and Long Winters. And he was telling the audience, like, we weren't responding to him well. And he's like, you know, I'm used to playing for much cooler audiences. What? I think you guys just don't appreciate good music. And I'm right in the front row planning to steal Silver Jew's playlist, which I did. And don't ask. It was just a goal. And
I still have it.
Oh, it's somewhere around here. Very neat
find
handwriting.
It and send me a picture of it.
Yeah, or maybe we sold it on eBay. Matt's got it. Yeah, very neat handwriting. What's his name? Very neat handwriting. But anyway, I'm right in front of him, and I just, again, that angry Irish tiny person, and I just start essentially telling him the very witty idea, Seattle sucks! You nice. Suck!
Nice. Igniting the crowd.
You,
I love it.
Telling the truth. I've been there. Seattle does.
I love it. And you did it in the right crowd. They were looking that kind of
thing. It was at that point, it was pandemonium.
Me and Murray, being the old men that we are, even though I know Silver Jews and everything, I had to look up Long Winters. And the first thing I get is, he does a podcast with Ken Jennings.
He looks like the guy. Now that I know who that is, he looks like the guy who would do a podcast with Ken Jennings.
Yeah.
Oh, you know that guy's secretly Republican. Ugh.
Ken Jennings is?
No, sorry, the Long Winters guy. Anyway.
Oh, okay.
I wouldn't be shocked if Ken Jennings is.
No, I wouldn't be shocked either, but he comes off so pleasant on TV. At least he can make an appearance on TV and not seem like a piece of shit.
Yeah.
He seems nice, even if he crossed the picket line, which I think is lame.
Oh, he did? Oh, because Jeopardy's doing new episodes.
I thought they had finished everything before the...
Yeah, I thought they were still on reruns. Like, I watched it for the first time in, like, 2 months yesterday.
Yeah, I hope it's just rumors, yeah, because that would suck.
That would be lame.
Speaking of things that suck and that are lame.
Oh, boy. Yes.
Point Break.
It's
time to get Point Break. First of all, does anyone know what a Point Break is? Anyone.
Is that the point where you become gay?
Well, in the metaphorical sense, I'm talking about the literal sense.
Oh, okay.
What is a point break?
Breaks it off and you're, Oh,
I thought it was the literal sense. The moment you realize you're gay, it's Point Break.
I'm looking it up. Not one of us looked this up. A type of wave characteristic of a coast with a headland. Now we have to look up headland, right?
Yeah. We're going down the Wikipedia
Is there
wormhole.
A question? Is there a surfing scene in Oregon?
Yes, there is. We have something called the Banana Belt that hits southern Oregon, and it's really quite warm and clement. It's actually one of our best-kept secrets. We try not to tell outsiders that there's this little bit of the Oregon coast that is wonderfully warm and fun.
Oh,
you can look
you
up pictures.
Golan-Globus?
Yeah, Gold Beach. Yeah, you can look it up. Gold Beach, Oregon. It's absolutely gorgeous. And yes, they have a surfing scene, although I guess it's pretty intense because Oregon coastline is full of wrecked boats and places called like Cape Heartache, Cape Fear.
So. That's where Cape Fear is?
Oh, no, not that Cape Fear. Like, we have our own Cape. We have a bunch of Cape You're Gonna Die, Cape Human Meat Grinder, you know.
It sounds like a fun.
But
like,
surfing culture was huge.
It does.
Yeah. Surfing culture was huge at my high school. Suddenly, it was like 8th grade, 7th grade, and suddenly all the boys were wearing board shorts and stupid shirts and sex wax shirts that some of the teachers would make them turn inside out because they didn't like the word sex.
Oh, we had our own when I was going through high school because The Rock came out with Poontang Pie. And he had this awful illustration of like it was a... I can never say this word correctly because my mouth and brain. Anthropomorphic bowl eating a piece of pie. And
a bowl.
Yeah, because the Rock is the... I forget what he called himself. The human bowl or something.
Oh, bowl. I thought you said a bowl.
No, bowl.
Bowl.
With horns.
Yeah, bowl.
Yeah, bowl.
I keep hearing bowl.
Bowl.
All right, maybe it's because I'm from the Midwest. I despise California and all things surfer culture. So this was a rough one for me. I hate that bro shit and the dude. It's all about the. In fact, the group I'm most identified with was the surf Nazis in this movie because If I was into surfing, it would just to be radical, as Bodhi claims. I don't give a fuck about the spiritual side of surfing. I don't believe there is a spiritual side to surfing.
And you are an early Chili Pepper fan.
No, I've never been a Chili Pepper fan. I do remember them back in the day, but, you know.
Griff, who did you identify with most?
Oh, Jesus Christ. I would be like the dude in a dock or in an Oxford, maybe hanging out with spiritual bros, because violence is weird to me. I've heard people get punched in the face, and I just get, like, creeped out by it, and I'm just like, I gotta get away from that.
So you're kind of like a Bodhi.
He
hates violence, too. He likes getting other people to do violent things for him.
I'm just not a narcissist like Bodhi is, though. Yeah. That's the problem. So I couldn't be hanging around with Bodhi either, because he would annoy the fuck out of me. Like the 5 a.m. wake-up call. Hey, I got the 5-foot waves out there, bro. I'd be like, fuck off. I got to wake up at 8 to watch my cartoon, drink my coffee, and then maybe
a slice of poontang pie, and then get your day started.
I got some poontang pie that's going to go bad in like another day or two. I got to eat that shit.
Poontang pie goes bad?
Of course poontang pie. I can't pontificate on this
point. I could always eat a slice of poontang pie. But, Who do you identify with?
I was
going
to say that it says something about my friend Carrie and I, that we were way too sympathetic to John McGinley's character Harp, who's just trying to do his job. I don't know what that says about us, her being a mom, and, you know. He's just doing his job.
It sounds like you guys care more about property crimes than anything else. Like, oh, someone stole from the Walgreens. That's what that sounds like, McGinley.
You even wrote
in your notes that McGinley's ripped. He's wearing a suit jacket in this whole movie. What are you looking at?
Maybe I imagined that shot of his arms. Maybe I dreamt it.
I think you did, because I went to that scene.
There was one scene where he had sleeveless dress.
Oh, he did?
On.
Okay,
yeah,
okay.
He was flexing. Yeah.
Okay, so maybe you didn't imagine it.
Because he's just there to yell at our heroes and say they're out of control.
Yeah, that's it. He's the every cop in all of our movies.
Right.
Like,
he's the geek, the nerd, the number cruncher, the guy who never uses his gut ever.
Ever. Never uses gut. Even to digest food. He still just does it in,
he just,
you know,
vomits.
Yeah, he just vomits. He's a fly. He vomits on it first and then consumes it. Fucking disgusting.
And he hates donuts.
He hates donuts. All right. I feel like we're finally getting to a point where we're ready to talk about this movie.
The greatest gay love story.
And we are at 27 minutes, so we win that bet.
All right. Are we ready to throw to the trailer? Are we ready to break
our points? Aabra, anything else for the top half?
No, great.
You can just pull a fakesies on everybody, and after the trailer, just go back to the top half. We've done it before, but anyways.
All right, everybody. Get ready to hang for 10 hours. As we delve.
How long have you been preparing that one?
It just came to me. That's how good I am.
It was your Point Break?
As we delve into the world, the homoerotic world that is Point Break.
It's the ultimate rush. There's nothing that comes close to it. Not even sex.
We are the ex-president.
Total commitment. It's a real thin line between life and death.
I'm not a crook!
It's not tragic to die doing what you love. If you want the ultimate, you gotta be willing to pay the ultimate price.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, and please don't forget to vote!
You wanna nail the bank robbers and be a big hero?
Definitely. The ex-presidents are surfers.
You're trying to tell me the FBI is going to pay me to learn to surf?
Fear causes hesitation. Hesitation will cause your worst fears to come true.
We'll take you to the edge. Past it.
This is gonna be a great day, Johnny.
You think taxpayers would like it, Utah, if they knew that they were paying a federal agent to surf and pick up girls?
Babes.
Big one.
The correct term is babes, sir.
Adios, amigo!
One adrenaline. Neither one of you have anything even remotely interesting to tell me.
Caught my first tube this morning, sir.
Perfect trailer. Probably 4 minutes long with this. It's probably awful rock that sounds like a rock song you've heard before. Like, I heard one song that I was like, is that Smoke on the Water? Nope, not quite. There was Hendrix in this movie,
yeah,
though, wasn't
there? Yeah, there was Hendrix.
Okay, that was like
I think originally the movie, according to IMDb, and I believe everything I read in IMDb.
As you should.
It was going to be called Riders on the Storm, the Doors song. But then they realized that it has nothing to do with surfing, so they scrapped it.
I mean,
kind of a cool name for a movie,
no,
Riders
on
the
Storm. That's a pretty good name.
Yeah, the big surf at the end of the movie, yeah. Like the big...
The 50-year storm.
Yeah, the 50-year... I think that would have worked out pretty good.
They didn't think so. They said Point Break.
And we open this movie with some sweet-ass surfing and target practice in the rain.
Yeah. What was that about?
I don't... Can we just get a temperature check real quick here? I want to know. Are you a sleaze for the Reeves? Or are you crazy Swayze? Which way are we leaning so far?
Now? Opening?
At the opening, how are you opening up? How are you feeling? You're seeing Keanu Reeves dripping wet, shooting a gun. How are you feeling about him?
Oh, dear. Keanu Reeves has this incredible trans mask, almost dyke energy. Like beyond androgynous. And Patrick Swayze, he's got that dancer body. And there's times when he's dressed almost like my mom.
He does like wearing those dance shoes without socks, I noticed in this movie.
There's a bit where he's standing by the plane and he's got those stupid Tai Chi pants and a tucked in shirt and his hair is all fluffy. And I really did expect my mom to go, "Where are my keys?" sunglasses.
We need you to take a side, though.
Offensively, Keanu.
Keanu, you're a sleaze for the Reeves. Okay, yes. Murray.
Well, at this point, because I don't know these characters yet, I got to go with Reeves because he's shooting a gun.
Right.
I just surfing. Fuck you. I don't care about that.
Right.
So, yeah. What are you?
I mean, we've only seen one character, so it's obvious. I'm also a sleaze for the Reeves.
Well, it helps that, like, so Keanu Reeves, like, we've said this many times, because we've covered him before. You can't hate Keanu Reeves.
We just heard Aabra's description of what she sees in Keanu. I've never seen that before. Everyone has their own image they project on
Keanu.
Right,
like, I've always said this. That's, if you want to be a star... Everybody loves you. You need to be a blank slate.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone can project whatever they want onto
you. Every description you had for Keanu, I was like, yep, I see that. I see that perfectly.
Dyke energy? Yeah, I get that.
No,
yeah.
I get that big time off Keanu. I get it. I love it.
Yeah, he's this walking anime. You know, he's not really... His face... Does he have a face?
That's a good question. No one has ever asked if Keanu is wearing a mask or if he has a face under it.
And when he has sex, he sticks his tongue out and crosses his eyes.
Oh, Jesus. Murray heard anime and got focused on it. Laser focused. Yeah. I saw the concentration.
I'm trying to get hip with the kids. I'm old, all right?
These kids.
The kids love their anime. You want to talk Speed Racer, guys? You want to talk G-Force? I'm there.
I want to talk Speed Racer. All right.
So we're establishing that Johnny Utah, great fucking action movie star name.
Or as Aabra would put it, porn star name.
We're establishing he's a crack shot. He's got all the stuff he needs, but except experience.
He's a crack shot with a shotgun, too. That's amazing.
Well, anybody can be a crack shot with a shotgun because it's a scatter gun. It just, you know, it's not that hard.
Right.
But, yeah, so, and we learned that it's because he's got that hand-eye coordination because he's a star QB at the Ohio State.
Yeah, we're going to go ahead and start planting those seeds right now. Our rival, by the way, because, of course, me and Murray are big Michigan Wolverine
Go Blue.
Fans. Go Blue. Maize and Blue.
So he's so good, he's doing it in the rain. His shirts are sticking to his body. His hair's flopping everywhere.
And just as quickly as you get that rainy, sexy, androgynous human being, you get flipped over to him in a suit. How are you
Well,
feeling?
You do get the moment where the guy goes... 100% on the course.
Perfect.
Yeah, real fast. My friend Carrie's dad was an LA cop. Yes, during all the riots and stuff. And I said, "Do they make them train in the rain?" And she just looks at me deadpan. She goes, "They don't wait for a nice day to do crimes, Aabra."
Why is it only rains in LA in our movies? Because
that's
it
a
never
good point.
Rains in LA.
That's a good point.
So like you say, yeah, Johnny Utah, first day on the job, he just got out of Guantanamo. Is that – no, wait. What's the place where the FBI agents go? I think Guantanamo's where we torture people. What is it?
Fuck.
Quantico.
Quantico.
I know.
Yeah,
I
he's training in the legendary Quantico, Virginia, wherever their secret compound is, where I guess the deer have learned real fast that they're never being shot at, so they just wander around.
Hey, deer are fucking stupid as shit, so –
You got a few that live in your
I have a few that live in my backyard.
I just saw one working. It was literally just laying there. That scared me at all. And I took a picture and then left.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess there's a whole little clan of, like, I don't know if they're muleys or buck, whatever they are. And they figured out real fast, oh, no one's shooting at us. Let's just live here.
Yeah, that's typically how it goes. It's like we've gone ahead and killed off all their land that they live on. So why not?
So I'm assuming Johnny was top of his class.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
He also went to law school, by the way, people. He's not.
And he's only 25.
Right. He's not just a himbo. He's you know, star quarterback.
Yep.
Law school, and FBI hotshot at age 25.
Real quick, out of 10, where are you putting Keanu in this suit, Aabra?
Oh God.
Serving it up.
It's pretty tasty.
Tasty eight. I like it. All right, so our tasty eight is heading in to meet his superior, one John McGinley, a.k.a., well, not a.k.a., known as, Murray, what is happening? Known in this movie as Ben Harp.
That's his name? Isn't that a singer, Ben Harp, Harper? Something like that? Anyway, great fucking biceps, by the way. We could see it through the tube. Mm-hmm. Me and Aabra could see it. We're like, great.
Yeah.
I called up Joe Coleman. I said, what do you think? Is the striations on the
muscles? Joe did say that is what you're going for with your biceps when you're wearing a jacket over your arms.
And like we said, he's a square. He's all Mr. I crunch numbers. Look at these computers. We use computers in this place.
Do you know how we close case, sir? We close it using analytics. We put analytics against real-life situations. We weigh out the odds. We figure out the fucking goons because the goons don't have the brains that we have. We have brains. What do you eat, sir? What do you eat?
And he's chomping on a donut right as he's saying that.
I eat chicken without skin, sir.
And then he says, look, mister, you're young, you're dumb, and you're oh so full of cum. I like what you're doing, buddy.
Bank robbery division.
Right.
Because apparently L.A. had a California at large, the western coast, had a burst of bank robberies in the 90s.
Yeah, got to fund the surf culture somehow.
I got to say, when we start talking about the numbers of robberies that are happening by the ex-presidents who we're about to meet, the numbers are all over the place. It's total politics. Because at one point, it's like... Yeah, right before they leave, they rob a bank. And then all of a sudden, they rob three banks in 4 days.
They rob on average 10 a year.
Yeah.
Because they do 30 in 3 years.
Oh, okay.
But it's only during the summer months, which we'll learn later.
Yeah, the rate is nuts, exactly. They'd have Brinks on each bank at this point. They'd all be on lockdown. My mom worked at a bank in the 60s and 70s during the heyday of California bank robbery that probably inspired this now outdated plot. Oh. And yeah, my mom did so many drills right out of Dog Day Afternoon. She actually said there were parts of Dog Day Afternoon that just felt like an afternoon to her because they would just grill you in how to go through it because they were getting robbed so often.
Interesting. That's really fucking cool. Did she ever like meet up? Oh, that'd be a fucking good idea for a sitcom. Like you're a banker by day and you end up hooking up with like the bank robber who robbed you earlier and you don't really know it until later.
Because he's wearing a president.
Because he's wearing a president. It's fucking good. See, all this is
was good.
I would know because the first question I ask anybody after a second day is, what president is your favorite president? So I would figure it out.
You'd figure it out. Yeah. You'd be on them right away.
But okay, so we meet the guy that never gets anything done, Harp. Now we're going to meet the partner who, hey, he's got his ways. They're unorthodox.
He's got his sways.
He doesn't follow the rules, but he gets shit done.
I love this. And we're at the swimming pool. I love a good fucking indoor pool. I want an indoor pool. Yeah, I've got four indoor pools.
Apparently, FBI does a lot of underwater operations.
Of course. Murray, it's the swimming is the perfect exercise. Look at Michael Phelps. That man is fucking chiseled. And he doesn't have the same wear and tear on his joints that you would get by running on pavement, herkin jerkin, or whatever those fucking weightlifting things are called. So this is the way to go. So he's got to be blindfolded and go in. So he puts a blindfold over his face, and then...
This is like Navy SEAL training. Like, what the fuck does this have to do with the FBI?
Right. Then that's where we get the turn of... we're going to learn about Busey, Gary Busey. Angelo Pappas.
His character's name.
Yeah. I think that was the first crush I had in grade school, Nicole Pappas. Yeah, that was weird.
These names are so ridiculous. Pappas, he's the father figure. Harp, who harps on them. Come on.
Put that together. That went right over my head.
I didn't even put that together.
And then Johnny's a Mormon. That's why he's from Utah.
Holy shit. That's why the underwear.
Isn't Bodhi some kind of Hindu thing?
Bodhisattva or whatever.
By the way. The name infuriated me, but we'll go on.
Yeah, we figured it was a tribute to Johnny Unitas.
Yeah,
Utah Unitas. Maybe
they even said it.
They call him that at one
point.
Yeah.
I think he says it right. Well, Busey is upset. He's got his blindfold on, and he starts complaining about
he's
the fact that he has
a meatball sub, and he's about to choke. Which, by the way, cramps. You don't want to do that.
You don't want to do that. A lot of bread, and you put breadcrumbs into a good meatball, so that's double bread.
Right.
I'm visualizing him trying to retrieve a meatball sub from the bottom of the pool.
Hey,
he would do that by smell.
I'm just thinking of that Nirvana cover and Gary Busey trying to reach out for a fucking meatball sub.
That's a great image. Yeah.
Thank you. I want that
on a t-shirt.
We can all imagine it just right now. And so he's got the blindfold on and he starts complaining about the fact that he has to fucking take.
Gotta break in a new partner.
Some fucking Johnny. Johnny Punk or something like that. Johnny Chimpo.
As he's saying this, our buddy Johnny Utah's watching it.
He's right there standing in front of him. He's 2 inches away from his face. Why is Johnny so close? Personal space, Johnny. And he's breathing into his mouth. And I forget how we introduced this.
Smelling those meatballs.
Yeah.
I just like the master shot of all of these shirtless men, like Catherine Bigelow's just coming up with any excuse to show more hot men.
That's right. You gotta have hot men every. See, here's what's probably missing from modern movies today: the homoeroticism that's just so subtle and perfect in every scene. It's like if you watch it, you get it. But I've watched a lot of these movies, and I was like.
Everybody had a bandana hanging out of their swim trunks. Yeah,
right.
Great. Yeah.
Right. And I don't even want to get on this whole fucking train of groomerism and everything. I saw John Claude's glutes from a young age, and I grew up straight, but I appreciate the man's glutes. We were talking about his glutes today. We got no good glutes in this movie.
Yeah.
Is there
There's
one
some
good
sad glutes in this movie?
Is there Aubrey, can you
Yeah, one us? one of the skydivers is showing off. He's got like kind of a four-pack. Later.
We're not talking about the front. We're talking about the back.
You have a four-pack on your ass?
I thought you guys said abs. Oh, I don't know what I heard. No. Glutes. No, the... Yeah, you're absolutely right. Lori Petty's butt's pretty good. Yeah.
If I remember correctly, my favorite character in this movie, Violent Naked Woman, had a pretty nice body.
Yeah. No, Violent Naked Woman definitely had the best body in the movie.
Yeah.
And the best action in the movie.
Yes.
Like, I could do a whole, like, we should do a whole spinoff about her.
I would love to see. After seeing that, I was like, I want to know her backstory.
Point Break 2.
James Cameron probably wrote 10 pages of her backstory.
Do you think
it all left out.
I'm worried we're getting ahead of the plot, but do you guys agree that the amazing beatdown in Peacemaker was inspired by Hot Naked Mama. Do you remember when John Cena gets a shit kicked out of him of a little tiny naked woman? No?
No.
No.
I've never seen it. Oh, wait. No, I know. Okay. I know what you're talking about. The TV show. Okay. Oh,
yeah. TV show Peacemaker. Yeah.
Oh, that's that modern show. That.
I remember him getting beat up by a little like Filipino dude. I don't remember.
Yeah. He takes a girl home and then realizes something about her and she just starts kicking the shit out of him.
Wow.
And I'm pretty sure it was just in, yeah, it was in John Cena's writer. Like, I will be beat up by a naked woman today. You know?
Well, Point Break is very influential, so I would not be surprised.
So we've got a good amount of ribbing happening here because after the whole blindfold ruse that Johnny Utah plays on his new partner, Angelo Pappas, he unblindfolds himself and it's just like, oh, fuck. He realizes he fucks up immediately. The two are fast friends, though. They love that they have like the same kind of joking energy.
Because old they guy, go by their gut. He can see that.
That's right.
He's like, finally, a guy can relate to.
Now I gotta get me some bricks.
You know, Pappas doesn't know how to turn a computer on.
That's right. He refuses. Yeah. He's Murray. I will not learn how to touch a keyboard. I will put my ass cheeks on that keyboard, and that is the way I will type. And so I love this because it's the first time we get to see somebody with some character and enthusiasm, something to bring to the movie. Well,
a personality,
a personality, aside from John McGinley, who I think is amazing as the stern, harping cop. God, how did that go over our heads? When Busey's like, I got to get some bricks, blindfolds himself again and does like a cannonball flip into the pool. And I loved it. I was like, yes. Busey. And so I want everyone to know my gauge has shifted. I'm no longer a sleaze for the Reeves. I'm on the bus. E. Gary Bussy. I'm on the Bussy.
Bussy means something very specific.
Oh, I know what that means.
On Grindr, I would be careful with the use of that word.
I know what that means. I'm on the Gary Busey. I'm trying to work bus into his name because his name starts B-U-S. Right.
So right off the gate, this is like the hottest crime going. Why would a guy who's just got out of Quantico be put on this job to begin with? Because I don't know. Maybe they need a set of fresh eyes because they're trying to catch these guys.
You know what? That's a good. You really do need to put some fresh eyes on a situation and everything.
So they go to the crime scene, and they're going over the security tapes. And while we're getting a little exposition about how great by the way, the bank robbers are called the ex-presidents because they wear the masks of Reagan, Nixon, LBJ, and Jimmy Carter.
Okay. Peanut farmer, Jimmy Carter.
Where's Michigan's own Gerald Ford? I don't know. He got short shift.
Yeah. He's a piece of shit for partying Nixon.
Well, yeah. Yeah, he had to save the country, man.
That's right.
Right? We would have went down the tubes if Nixon had went to jail.
Peanut tubes.
So they're going over the footage, and he's like, let me tell you something here. These ex-presidents of the 27 banks in the past 3 years, they're in and out in 60 seconds.
I think it was 90. I think I got that wrong.
Whatever.
I think it was 90.
I think gone in 60 seconds is what we were thinking about that movie.
Yeah.
That's how fast you have to be to steal a car.
And of course, Murray, the most important part, how you never get caught in those 60 to 90 seconds. You never get greedy.
Yeah, you steal from the till. You just take the ones and the fives.
What does Mama Aabra have to say about that? Is that how you get
That is true. They don't do die packs, or at least the banking stories I've heard, they don't do die packs at the drawer level. If you can just empty the cash drawer. So as long as they aren't taking the cartoonish bags with the die packs hidden in them, because then those explode on you.
That was a plot point in a really good movie, Hell or High Water, where they also robbed banks and they only stole from the tills.
Yeah.
So that's what we're going to do, guys.
That's what we're going to do.
So we're going to be called the ex-prime ministers, and we're going to go with famous Canadian prime ministers.
I guess I get to be Kim.
I got Trudeau, because that's the only one I know. The original,
Thurgood Marshall? Was that one?
Thurgood Marshall, yeah.
That sounds like a British name.
So while that's going... So, like, you know, Pappas eats, sleeps, and breathes this case. He's got to get these guys. The other guys working on the case, it's a joke to them.
They have the goofiest straight-edge haircuts. They're kind of they're like long and short in a weird way. I hated these people. I hated their faces.
That's what they wanted you to do.
They did a great job of it. I don't know.
And they're like, hey, Pappas, tell him your theory.
Oh, yeah, get him with that good theory.
And then we're like, wait, we're on the edge of our seats waiting for that theory. But no, they tease us a little. Because Harp walks in, flexing nonstop.
Oh, my God.
Kissing his biceps. I thought that was a little overboard.
Through the jacket and everything.
Yeah.
He's getting
he's yelling bizarre things like, try to take these guns.
And he's like, he's like, look, ladies, somebody needs to investigate that getaway car that got left out there.
Obviously, this is fucking chump work. So Pappas is already like, hey, boss, I got a meatball sandwich waiting for me. I got to get out of here. And God damn it, he's tagged up with old fucking Keanu, baby boy.
You got to remember, at this point, Utah. Johnny.
Yeah, I couldn't remember his name.
He's strictly by the book because he hasn't developed his gut yet.
That's right.
I mean, Pappas sees the germ of a gut.
Is eating meatball sandwiches how you get the gut?
It might be.
Because he orders tuna, Johnny Utah.
Yeah, on like wheat.
He orders tuna on wheat.
Dry wheat.
Dry?
It's like it's called a Griff sandwich. Make it as dry as possible.
Could you actually take the mayonnaise out of the tuna so it's just dry? Like put it under the heat lamp for like 9 days?
And then Johnny's probably trying to get in good with Harp. He's like, we'll do it, bro. So next thing you know, we're at the getaway, on the side of the road where the getaway car is. They're examining, Johnny is examining the sweat patterns on the chairs.
Right, that's right. He's like, oh my God, bro, this car did not have air conditioning. You know what I could tell? Sweat out. This is Columbo level shit. I loved it.
Which, when you think about it, is an important plot point to this movie because it's about a because there's probably some butt sweat stains there. And this movie's all about using butts to solve crimes. I bet Jackie Stallone, they should have like had a scene where they went to her, because she was a rumpologist, Griff. You know what that is?
Yeah, I do know about
so they went to her like as a psychic rumpologist, and they said, hey, we got these sweat patterns. Can you tell us?
That would be an amazing scene.
Yeah. Oh, my God. They get
but are we skipping over the most important part? Please. That on the closed caption TV, which somehow does an up angle, that they've sharpied on the guy's butt. Thank you. Did we do that yet?
Oh, you know, you're right. Because when they were viewing the tape at the crime scene, they look at that. Yeah.
It said thank you on his butt, right?
Thank you.
It's written on his butt, I assume by Bodhi.
It's very legible, so that means he did
Bodhi
not do it.
Wrote on the booty. That's
this is
right.
The one part I didn't like. They didn't realize that thank you is written so legibly. So it couldn't have been by him. Somebody wrote it on his butt.
Yeah, because it wasn't backwards. Yeah. Usually you'd do it in the mirror, it would come out backwards.
Yeah, and it came out perfect.
They're getting ready to do the robbery, and they go steal a car, and they check the masks, and they get the bags, and then he bends over and pulls down his pants and goes, somebody do my butt.
Somebody butt.
It's a tense situation. You need a little levity to like lighten the mood. And of course, Nixon would totally do that because he was when the streaking fad was going on really hard and heavy. It was during Nixon's administration. So it would make sense that Nixon would be all about showing the ass.
Was it?
Yes.
Interesting. I have seen. Okay.
So.
Oh yeah, Griffey. They streaked the Oscars, or what? Wait, yeah, Tim, was it the Oscars or the Grammys?
Because David Niven said something about some guy's shortcomings or something. He had a nice little zinger on the guy.
That's a good.
And then don't forget the classic Ray Stevens novelty song, "The Streak."
I mean, that seems to be when all the good streaking footage for baseball comes from, or any sports.
Yeah, it was a magical time, Griff.
Wieners everywhere.
I was just. But a wee infant, but I'm glad I lived during that time.
It's good because you still get them maybe once or twice in the full baseball spectrum across all 85 teams that there is now. You get like maybe two a year, but they have too much camera production team. You never see it.
So Pappas is like, why are we wasting our time on this shit? And he's just like, sweat patterns, fuck that. And then... Johnny's like, I can use this.
Yeah, Johnny starts getting hot. He's getting in his face. You think you got this thing all solved by yourself? Fucking grandpa choking on your fucking meatball subs. I see the fucking marinara running down your white shirt, you piece of shit. You old crusty bastard. You don't even eat wheat. Your fucking bread is so moist I can see all the fucking dribblets walking out of your mouth. Wow. What the fuck is wrong? And This gets Gary Busey into method acting mode. You know Gary Busey went full method and ate 9 meatball sandwiches a day for this role. Right. You could see it in his gut and his face. And so he starts getting offended, and he starts pushing back on Utah. He's like, are you fucking mad now? Are you fucking mad? I am mad. Good. We're going to get this case solved.
Feels good to be angry, doesn't it, bro?
Tell me about the theory. You want the theory? You want the theory?
And then now we cut back to we're at the FBI headquarters, not well, the LA base.
So we get a nice little bro down, and Aubra loves a good little bro down over some Coronas and whiskey.
Yes. But just for the listeners at home, the theory is that the robbers are surfers.
Makes perfect sense.
Dun, dun, thank dun.
Why? Because we get that nice butt shot, and he's like, only a surfer would have tan lines. That the whole thing hinges on tan lines, which, like I said, our buddy Joe Coleman would never get caught because he wouldn't be caught dead with tan lines.
Yeah, tan lines and wax. They wax the boards, I guess.
Yeah, it's called like Carnova wax.
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
Because they got like a hair sample or something.
Yeah, hair sample.
From their shoes.
Yeah.
And they go, there's traces of silicon, which is sand, people. And there's all these, like, arsenic, all this, like, carcinogenics.
Right. There's it's so good. There's a bunch of weird little bits in there. And so they're just, like, formulating their plan.
And Johnny, logically, is going, this is all bullshit. Like, what is this? But there's no other choice. I guess it has to be.
No,
this.
He's doing devil's advocate to make sure they get to the right conclusion.
He's scullying.
Here. So, yeah.
The mold,
so
he's, yeah.
Back, and he's like, but what about this? What about that? And then Busey comes right back and just like, no, man, this is why it's this way. And he's like, fuck, I know how we can take this to the next level.
Because he's like, look, the robberies always happen during the summer months, the greatest time to serve. And they always end when the, you know, summer's over with.
Right.
And they follow the waves, bro. You can just, I guess they just go all over the world robbing banks.
That's right.
So, no, hey.
At least the coastal world. They need waves to ride. So,
yeah, they're not robbing Kansas.
Yeah.
No.
So we get the cutaway after they decide, Keanu, Johnny Utah, you got to become a surfer. I don't know anything about surfing. Hey, you're a quarterback. It's all about agility, footwork, hips.
Balance.
Yeah, you'll figure it out. No big deal. And we're at the next morning, and we're coming on to my favorite throwaway character. You brought it up in your notes as well, Aubra. You brought up, like, this movie's turning me into a libertarian. I saw that 8-year-old working at the surf shop, and I was like, yeah, you know what? Kids should work at surf shops. You know, kids should work everywhere. 8-year-olds should be doing full-time jobs. Yeah. They learn a lot more. This kid's speaking fucking wisdom.
Well, Johnny shows up at a surf shop dressed in a suit, and he's asking about what's the best board, and the kid gives him like the shittiest one, but he charges him probably double, you know?
That's right.
Because like you said, he's learning how to be a capitalist. And then he says, well, I'm going to let you say the line because you loved it so much.
Oh, that's right. So, of course, Keanu buys the board. Hey, good luck learning. It's never too late.
I'm 25.
Like I said, you're never too late. Let me tell you, I hope you keep with it. It's a source. It'll change your life, bro.
And right now I'm vomiting because I hate spirituality, period. But I really hate it when it's put into surfing.
And when...
Riding a fucking board on a wave.
Not to mention this kid's hair's all over his ears.
Oh, my God. I wanted to just shave his head.
The only thing that was missing from this movie, you pointed out, was puka shells.
Yeah, he needed a little puka
shell. Nobody had puka shells in this movie.
But Swayze had the beautiful blonde highlights, so it made up for it. So, all right. So he can go undercover as a surfer. But he's got to learn first.
That's right.
So, like you said, Pappas, he's like, I don't know if I can surf, bro. He's like, we already got the lingo down. He talked like a surfer. You just got to learn to be a surfer.
And
how hard could it be? You're a QB. You're a star.
So this is where we get kind of our footage of him trying to learn to surf, but apparently he picked the wrong beach because he happens on a feisty...
We got baby elephant playing in the background. It's beautiful.
That has a name to it. Of course it does. Baby elephant. Yeah.
And there's no classes. He couldn't sign up to learn how to surf.
But that would ruin his cover.
That's what an FBI agent would do.
Yeah.
I'm tagging Aubra and I'm going pee. Good luck, Aubra.
So he no pun intended, wipes out many a time until a young lady takes pity upon him. A young lady with a great glutes, according to you, Aubra, correct?
She has a nice round ass. And that's a peachy. That's a peachy butt.
Played by Lori Petty. Was this around? This was around the League of Their Own era, right? Lori Petty.
Yeah, she and Madonna shared a trailer, and I guess people were terrified to go knock on the door or go in because they spent most of their time in that trailer nude.
She was channeling some Madonna. I got a Madonna vibe off her look in this movie. She was kind of channeling Madonna, so that makes sense. So she's just like, hey, Moondoggy, I don't know whatever the fucking surfer lingo is. I'm using Gidget like lingo here. Like, get off the beach. She's gatekeeping is what she's doing, basically. She's like, you're not good enough for this beach. Get out of here before you get killed. And I'm just trying to learn. So, where am I at? I'm lost in my notes.
Yeah, my friend Carrie at this point, because I got a little puzzled, saying, I mean, he's a jock. Why don't they accept you? She goes, but he's not. They don't like jocks, Aubra. They're surfers. It's a lifestyle. This isn't tennis. This isn't golf to them. And I'm like, okay.
That's true. You're right.
Mm-hmm.
This isn't a sport. This is a lifestyle.
That is true.
So, he's like, she's my in. I know I have a feeling about this girl. Tyler is the
The feeling is somewhere between his belly button and his kneecaps. His busted kneecap.
So he does what any man would do. He stalks her for a while. He's got the binocs on her.
I think, let's note this. He was talked down to by a local surfer, and he was like, yeah, I'm into that. Let's just register that for a second and move on.
Okay. So he's stalking her. He's watching her change out of her wetsuit into some Daisy Dukes.
That's right. She's got the towel method going on here.
Great.
Yeah.
I didn't see anything.
Very agile. Yeah. No. Because even the slickest of us, a butt cheek pops out or something. But no, nothing slips out.
And he gets her plate. So now he can use the power of the FBI to know everything about this woman.
This is where we get to meet. Oh, God. I gotta say, this movie had great throwaway characters because we have a character that comes up in like two scenes. Aubra, I think you were a big fan of this character too. Our Intel computer lead? I don't know what to call her.
Yeah. Yeah, she's just generic computer clerk lookup lady. She is so horny for Tyler's criminal record.
She likes a bad girl. What can you say?
Yeah, she's obviously like, who is she? Can you introduce me?
Yeah, I love this because they have. We're going into Megaforce Big Brother technology here. They have, like, so much information about her.
Well, you can, Griff. You can look up somebody's criminal record.
Well, yes, Murray, I understand that, but why did they have
her... FBI especially can do it.
Why did they have her turn-ons, turn-offs, that her parents died?
You're right about
that. That they had her waistline, that they had her bust line. They had way too many facts.
Well, in California, you have to actually fill out the Playboy data sheet to get a license, so... Because everyone's so fucking hot out there.
Oh, right. Of course. And so this is great because Johnny Utah and the Intel person who Murray... Horny Intel person who Murray said, that's like the never, no retreat, no surrender 3 computer guys role.
Yeah, which
role reverse.
Reference nobody gets. But
exactly.
Yeah,
right. So it's just for us, Franklin.
And it's just tons of, like, public intoxication, flashing her tits, like all these...
Flashing her tits.
Harmless things, stealing a baby Ruth from a gas station, nothing serious. But,
right.
She's got a little of an edge to her.
So when we do the prequel of this movie, it's just going to be 90% clips of her flashing her tits.
Right. And, like you said, horny intel girl, I want to get to know this person. I have the same turn-ons.
And so,
and then they notice that Tyler's parents had orphan. Her parents had died in a car wreck. And it's like, I can use that. Like every creepy predator would. You're like, yeah, I can use someone's like really trauma in order to get what I want from them. So that's his in.
Right.
Dead parents.
And we know where she works because that was also on the rap sheet as well.
Yeah, she works at Shrimpy's. Shrimpy's. They just sell shrimp and fries.
Nah, that's right. You don't want to ask what they do in the back.
Toe sucking?
That's right. Okay. I'm glad you figured it out.
But did you love how much Pappas was annoyed by this is his contact, but Gary Busey's character's made no progress in years?
Yeah. Was it just Pappas or was it Hap too?
Oh, maybe it was Harp.
Or Harp, excuse me. I thought it was Harp that was like really upset about it, but it might have been Pappas too, because again, he's been working this case for several years, and he's got nothing, so...
Yeah, they're like, he's like, green eyes, brown hair, this is your lead? And it's like, it's better than what you've come up with.
Nothing.
Yeah.
But it's because she's an icky girl, because remember, the theme of this movie is guy-on-guy action.
That's right.
So, Papa's like, what is she? She's got a vagina, what does she know? So, next morning, Johnny shows up at her work... And he orders the shrimp. He's like, I hear there's some good shrimp in here. He's like,
shrimping ain't easy, bro.
And she's like, oh, you're that loser from yesterday that I had to save. What are you doing here? Well, it's kind of like, this reminds me of when my parents died in a car wreck. And then she immediately, like, what?
No.
That was one of her turn-ons, by the way. Parents dying in car wrecks.
No build up to a story at all. Just gets right to the chase. Right. You know, shrimp and fries remind me of when my parents died. They used to take me to get shrimp and fries.
It reminds me of my parents wiped out. You know, that's what the surfing.
Yeah, you can see it in her eyes. She is so ready to give him a pity blowjob.
Yeah. Oh, geez. At least it's not a shrimp job.
So she's
I'm
like,
sorry, shrimpers.
You know what? We got a very Disney vibe here. We're orphans. I'm going to teach you how to surf.
That's right.
And so she's like, meet me at fucking 5 a.m.
Do not be late. If you're late, then this movie ends. So be on time.
So we get a nice little montage of him doing baby steps, falling off. They're on the whatever the surf version of the bunny slope is. That's where they're at.
Right. They're not even waves.
No, she's actually just pushing him.
Actually, they weren't even out on the ocean. They were on the beach, and she's constantly going, all right, now pop up, pop up. Why don't you understand pop up? This is what it's like to work in the tech world where people use lingo that you're like, that means nothing to me. Like if I were to say to you, automate, you know, like, I can't even think of a good tech world. But she's just using her own lingo, and he's just like, what? What is that?
And right, and remember, we didn't have the internet back then where you could look this shit up.
Right, so. You couldn't study, get a visual of what she's talking about. So she's an awful coach. She's yelling, pop up, you dumb fuck, pop up. Left foot, right foot, same time. Finally, she says, like, you need to elevate yourself and land both feet on the board at the same time. And he's like, oh, bro, I get that.
Right.
Shrimping ain't easy.
Hanging town.
Hanging down.
So, a long morning of this pop up, nonstop pop up. He finally rides his first little wave.
Don't forget that you get some people walking by and they're laughing at Johnny too. He's never been laughed at in his life. He's a quarterback for fuck's sake.
Star quarterback of the Ohio State.
You'd think he'd be drowning in puss, and here he is, just like, man, I gotta.
Well, he was until he fucked his knee up.
Oh well, there's a certain. Inside joke between me and my friends, the Hegeman one knee technique, and apparently Johnny, of course, he's never learned it.
No, he can't even pop up.
He can't even pop up.
So, all right, it's like baby steps. He finally rode his first tiny wave. So he's like happy. Look, I did it. She's like, that's nice. Come out of the water. You're getting wrinkles, getting pruny, and then out in the distance. See this flowing blonde mane just get flipped.
This is the perfect time for Dreamweaver to come.
This is where Catherine Bigelow shows her directing skills.
Yeah.
Because it just zoom in. You see the fucking the tan, the fucking white teeth, the blonde highlights. It's our hero/villain, yeah. Bodhi.
All right, guys. We have four options now. You can pick Johnny Utah. You could pick Patrick Swayze. You could pick Tyler, or you could pick Gary Busey if you're so inclined. Who are you going with? You got a picture of the Swayze now.
Well, being a straight man, I got to go with Tyler, apparently. I don't.
You're fucking lame.
I'm sorry.
You're just lying to yourself. Okay. Aubrey, who are you going with?
Are we going to get meatball subs? What are we doing?
Well, if you want to, you can take it whatever direction
I just
you
think.
Want.
I just think if you could restrain him like Silence of the Lambs, Gary Busey could tell you some amazing stories.
You want to tie up Gary Busey, I got that, and feed him meatball subs. Okay, that's cool. I just want to go get the meatball subs of Gary Busey still. So we got zero for our two leads. No.
Yeah, they're basically zeros, yeah. So, but he's like, who is that?
Oh,
and she's
God.
Like, that guy? Modern Savage.
He's looking for the ultimate ride.
That was a James Cameron line. That was
yeah,
that
you
was
think
amazing.
So?
Oh, you know it.
Rick King definitely did not write that
Modern
line.
Modern Savage.
We watch Kickboxer 3. Rick King, nowhere close to that line.
So Bodie notices Tyler, and this is where we learn they have a little history, because he goes in for a little peck, you know, just to claim his you know, territory.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, Aubrey, do you watch Always Sunny?
I've seen it, yeah.
Because he's kind of got the Dennis method going on here. Murray doesn't get that reference, but Dennis, the sexy character of the show, says he's got a method where he can get any girl he ever slept with again, and that's kind of what we see Patrick Swayze's character practicing here. Bodie's just like, yeah, no, I can come back around to any girl I slept with, and she'll still be insane for me. And I kind of think Tyler is still a little hot for him.
I don't know, because even Bodie points out near the end, he couldn't even get her.
That's true.
Yes, yeah. Griff is, you're close, Griffy. Tyler is, she's the strong female that's part of the group, and this has always been a fascination for James Cameron. He's obsessed with the one that got away, with the strong, independent woman who just doesn't need him because she's a strong, independent woman. So Tyler's written in a way that she don't need no man, and Bodie obviously courted and tried and got her, but he wasn't the one.
Shit, you put that, that was James Cameron quote?
Yeah.
Damn.
She's the one that got away.
It's like all his ex-wives, who he's on pretty good terms with, and I guess it's really complicated, admit that, yeah, he had a real, like, he wanted the kind of girls that didn't need men.
Yeah.
So, yeah, but since Bodie is, remember, Bodie's a malignant narcissist, so that fucking bothers him, that she's not that into him.
Yeah,
you know?
And so he comes in immediately with the insults on the new bow.
Right. Nice board, bro.
You know, I had a Chevy 57. Kind of resembled that board.
What they call it? A Chevy 57?
Yeah, pretty.
No, it's 57.
A 57 is Chevy?
Come on, we're from the Motor City, for fuck's sake. He's faking.
I drive a golf cart.
So, yeah, he's just totally fucking throwing shade at Johnny. Meanwhile, there's some tension, some sexual tension between these two.
Yeah, this is the first meet cute of the movie. You thought it was Tyler in Utah, but no, it's this. Yeah. This is the first meet cute.
What have we learned, people? Love comes from hate.
Murray, this is your line.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's true.
Yeah.
We've learned this from countless romantic comedies. If you don't hate this person, you're never going to love them.
Yeah. Everything about Bridget Jones' Diary taught me that.
If you meet somebody and you're like, I really like this person, it's doomed.
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 We have too much in common. We'll never get along. Or we'll always get along. That's the worst. And so it just so happens that his bros, Bodie's Brodies, are tossing around the old pigskin.
Right. And that's his in, because remember.
That's right. And so a ball goes errant, and Johnny Utah, looking like the fucking second coming of Jerry Rice, just reaches out, catches the ball with his fingertips, and reels it in. And they're like, Brody, are you fucking serious? You should stick around on the beach and play football under some headlights tonight. They have a bigger audience than most live shows we've been to for this beachfront, headlight-lit, non-sanctioned football game with a fighter pit in the middle of it.
Well, yeah, because that's how charismatic Brody is.
Real question here. How do you think this rates better or worse than the Top Gun volleyball scene?
Oh, this is because this pales in comparison to the top. If you want to talk about homoerotic, it doesn't get more homoerotic.
I'm not talking about homoeroticism, though. I'm just
talking about what quality of play? What are you talking about?
I'm just take it whatever you want. Do you think
you can barely see it? It's a nighttime game.
Okay.
Yeah, no, at this point, my friend Carrie added, this is their volleyball scene. She was very underwhelmed. She also threw in, I love this line, did the third grip write this music?
Third grip.
You know, like they just picked a random member of the crew and said, hey, got a guitar? Want to write a soundtrack? Okay.
You
the music
not,
sucks.
You are not wrong.
And remember, I don't remember the name of the song, but there was some great cock rocking going on in the Top Gun volleyball scene. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It was like the boys are back in town or something like that.
It had such good music. And this is obviously just this pale comparison of the volleyball scene.
You're okay. Yeah. Okay. I just wanted to make sure I, because I was just like, this got some tension to it. I just wanted to see.
It ratchets it up, Griff, because there's a scene where Bodhi goes wide, and Johnny chases him. And remember, this was supposed to be flag football, guys.
Yeah.
But Johnny, it gets the best. His old juices get flowing from the old college days.
That's right.
So he lays fucking Bodhi out right into the waves.
It's intense. Like, you literally, the music cuts. You hear a record scratch. Somebody brought a turntable with them for this fucking game. And everybody's like, Wody! Bodhi, are you okay? And so
they're ready to kick the shit out of Johnny.
Yeah.
He's their hero.
Who the fuck do you think you are? And that's when, of course, Bodhi steps in. He's Johnny Utah. Don't fuck with him. OSU.
So basically, what we're saying is, he knew Johnny all along, but he was throwing that shade, acting like he didn't know, because he didn't want to like fanboy out on him.
That could have been it. I don't know what to say about it, but I think, Aabra, you had this in your notes. He noticed that Johnny was a lefty, and that's what really fucking sold it.
Yeah, it's would that be an advantage in football? I'm not really a football person.
There's not a lot of left-handed quarterbacks. I mean, lefties are just kind of rare in general, but I can think of only like 3 starting quarterbacks today that are left-handed.
Hmm.
So it is pretty kind of interesting when you get a left-handed. Everything's designed for righties.
Yeah, because they could have reversed those shots. James Cameron used reverse shots in Titanic, of course. But I thought that was kind of cool that they stuck to it. Or it just showed that Catherine Bigelow didn't care.
We don't have the time to get into the Titanic.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Don't try to segue into that one.
But yeah, you can just feel the sexual tension that Utah wants to touch Bodhi so bad. And yeah, at this point, Bodhi's obviously sized him up. He only came over to talk to Tyler because he clearly saw Utah and said, ooh, what's this? And probably recognize him like you guys are saying. And just, the tension in the scene is amazing.
Right. I mean, Bodhi is a beach bum. He's out there just looking for any hot bod to lay with, right? So he's not fucking like... really picking through, he's just like, yeah, they all come in fun shapes and sizes, and he wants.
Yeah,
he
plus
wants
he really, if you think of him like a cult member, he's constantly sizing people up to be part of his little crew, and here's a guy who challenges him, who would dare to push him into the surf.
Right, that's very the master of him. I like that because the master was all about that. The one person who was so wild and got in the master's face. This is a Criterion podcast, by the way. All we do is talk about Criterion movies. And so clearly, Johnny or Bodhi is awestruck by Johnny Utah, super obsessed, knows his whole career, talks about every fucking stat he's ever had, like every nerd you ever hear who's obsessed with football. And it's just going off, and Johnny's like, yeah, that's right. I broke my knee, and then I got into law, and then... I ended up, now I work here doing the law. I just do the law. That's what I do at the law. Because he's trying to hide the fact that he's an FBI agent. He's got to hide that fact.
Using his own name, and he's 25, but he has clients? Why not make him a lowly law clerk or something?
Right.
Well, it's good he used his own name because Bodhi knew who he was. So,
That's true.
So, the next morning, Harping... on our boys. He's like, it's been 2 weeks, and you have no fucking leads. Oh, you're surfing on our team. What have you done? I caught my first two.
We can't forget the amazing line from Roach or whoever was on the beach before. Lawyers don't surf. Well, this lawyer does.
Lawyers and Charlie don't surf.
So good. So. But yeah, they're getting chewed out. Yeah. And that's when Keanu just cuts the tension with, bro, I caught my first tube this morning. And by the way, Gary Busey at this point, Aabra, thank you so much for this fucking website you sent me where this person broke down every outfit. Well, all the crazy outfits Gary Busey wears, which is like 4 or 5 in this movie. Amazing shit. It'll be in the show notes. Goddamn, Busey's just in there with his oversized... Fuck, I remember, I have pictures. I think I'm wearing a weird beach thing in that picture right there when I was like 4.
It was in
the 90s. He looks like, what's that, arrest photo of Nick Nolte? Do you remember that? Anyone who's never seen this film, yeah, Gary Busey really just looked like he woke up in the back of a car, put on a random Hawaiian shirt he found in the trash, and wandered in. It's like, sorry, Miss Bigelow, I'm here.
Yeah, 100%.
So, all we got now is his first tube. That's right. Basically all we got to go on. But horny lab girl. There's a lot of horny women working in the FBI, apparently.
Yeah, same lab girl as before.
Right.
This isn't a second horny lab girl.
Oh, wow, she's computers and, like, genetics because she has the...
She just had the data, I guess.
They got a hair sample from LBJ, one of the crime scenes. Maybe it was in that sweat pattern. And they're like, look, we found, like, these particular... Of course, there's peroxides. Everybody has their blonde hair. And we found all these, like, things. It could only be a one. Like, check other beaches that this would register.
Yeah, all of our beaches are fucking super polluted in unique ways. So if you just go get hair samples for each of them, we'll see if the hair has particulates from the specific beach. So we'll know which beach they were at.
They literally go to a beach that has, like, a factory, like, spewing garbage.
That was my favorite shot of the movie. Because that's probably fucking... I mean, obviously, that's real.
Right, yeah.
That's
probably
off.
Why they're, like, real-life surf gangs, because they want to protect their territory. Like, you go to the fucking cancer fucking beach.
For real?
Yeah.
That makes sense.
So we get a little, like, fun moment where they got to get a hair sample from these people on the beach to test it against the LBJ hair sample.
Right. Keanu goes up to a guy. Oh, my God, you got a bug in your hair, bro. Slaps him in the head and rips out the hair. He's like, oh, yeah, look at it. Oh, it's disgusting. It's crushed. Don't worry about it.
No due process. Would this stand up in court?
No.
There's no such thing as due process when you're using your gut. All right.
That's right.
That's right.
So they go. Guess what, guys? They got a match. This is the beach. If these guys are the biggest of badasses, why are they on shithole beach, right?
Didn't we cut to another beach, though?
I don't know. I'm
pretty sure we cut to, like, just some random beach here. Because
There's not many beaches in Southern California, so I'm sure they could knock that out in an afternoon.
That's right. So we're on some other beach, and we got Pappas in his awesome surfwear just sitting in his, oh, shit. This was written in that article. I forget what car it was. Do you remember what car it was?
No, I don't remember.
It was an 89.
It was not a Chevy 57.
No, it definitely was not a 57 Chevy. But yeah, some shitty car. And we got Pappas in there just looking through binoculars, trying to keep
Utah. It's funny
back.
That he, who's the guy who's like had a career, has the shitty car. But of course, Johnny, like every action movie hero, muscle car. He drives like a classic muscle car.
He did?
Yes, he did. There's one scene.
He has a little Mustang.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I didn't even notice.
Yeah.
And so this is where we're going to see that, as I think we've talked about on mic, we've talked so much today.
Not even halfway done, people.
We're not even halfway there. And so Johnny's out here, but he's on a certain surf gang's territory. And so he's just out there trying his damnedest to catch some waves
to pop
and everything.
Up.
Pop
Has up. He mastered popping up yet?
Right. He's barely mastered it. Like, he's still working through the rudimentary shit. And he happens to collide boards, and you get some awful ADR in here. Bro, get out of my tube!
Right. And he does the ultimate insult you can do to a surfer. He cuts the cord that they connect to their ankle to the board. So you lose your board.
The bro cuts Utah's board.
Yeah. And then Johnny's chesting, so he like gets out of the water and
right.
like, I'm just gonna wash off all this filth that I've been surfing.
Johnny has been he's got that, you know, that that problem where he's had so much success in his life. He's just been a straight trajectory upward, and now surfing's been the first time he's had people tell him, no, you're terrible at this. So he's gotta wash that filth off him.
Right.
You really gotta get in the mind of Utah here, Murray.
Yeah, and so he's doing that. And then this was the most disheartening moment of the whole movie for me. Because there's a character we low and love from our second ever episode, Cyborg.
Did you recognize this character, the lead of this gang, Aabra?
Yes, I've got a poster with his face on it from B-Movie Bingo. I did recognize him.
It's Mr. Fender Tremello from Cyborg. But I was like, what? When I was like, oh my God, did they actually dub him in Cyborg? Because I'm used to, I like living in the, you know, the apocalypse. Yeah. And it's this like nerd voice. Like, what are you doing here? Get off our beach. And I'm like,
I like this beach.
And then to add insult to injury, pans over and we see the lead singer of the Red Hot Chili Peppers, Grand Rapids own, Anthony Kiedis, with this crazy like mohawk. Like, what was going on with his hair? It was like he had the long hair and then he had it shaved on the sides.
Yeah.
But it was like Mr. T style where the hair went over the that really bugged me, Griff.
Oh, I know it did.
A mohawk where you actually leave hair over your ears.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was enraging me. I didn't know what to feel. Because I'm first of all, one of my heroes, Fender Tremello, nerd voice, Anthony Kiedis, talking about singing a song about California or some shit. And two other goons lay into our buddy, our hero, Johnny Utah. And it's behind some like bushes, so Pappas can't see it.
Yeah, and he's freaking out in the car. He's like, oh fuck, I can't see the kid. What's going
I lost
on?
Lost contact! Then? Where the fuck is he? Chomps on a meatball sub, you know.
Yeah.
Like Popeye. <Da-da-da-da-da-da>.
Wasn't there, I don't know if anybody else watched this show, but wasn't there a Married with Children where Al Bundy played a sandwich like a harmonica?
I don't know. I'm sure there could have been. I don't know.
Okay.
So it's 4-on-1, so he's getting handled. And fuck, remember, Fender Tremello, nerd voice, jacked fucking
dude,
body.
All these surfer bros, aside from Anthony Kiedis, yeah. are fucking... Anthony Kiedis was naked wearing a sock over his dick, by the way. So that's... Yeah. I was like, is that a member of the Chili Peppers or a super fan? And then I saw the sock and I was like, oh no, I recognize that sock.
Right. So they're pummeling him until Bodie flies into action. It's flying fucking jump kick.
I thought you were going to say Bodie waits for his music.
He did wait for his music.
What would Bodie's music be?
At this point, my friend Kerry, who is definitely Team Swayze, was like, oh, there's that dancer training.
Ooh. Yeah. She was fine with his little legs and everything, right?
There were some Rockettes jokes, yes.
Okay, because he's got tiny legs. He's got a great upper body, but he's got tiny little legs. Legs are hard. Joe Coleman will tell you. Legs are tough. You can't really fuck with that.
Well, he's fucking with these four guys because when him and Johnny are a team, they're unstoppable. And they just fuck these four guys up. Meanwhile, fucking Pappas is like, shit, I got to do something. So he's like, runs out with his gun out. Right into this. He doesn't know what's going on. I think he sees like a body go flying. So he's like, I got to shoot somebody.
Yeah.
So he runs down there. Meanwhile, Johnny and Bodie take care of business.
They're walking back up to the street. They're getting ready to walk to Johnny's car. But Bodie's going to walk him to his car. And this is where they confront with Pappas. And they have a nice little exchange here where he's just like, I'm just looking for some criminals that might be nearby here. And they're like, hey, bro, there's four criminals right down there. Sold me some skunk weed. I'm sorry, I'm coughing. I worked it into the bit.
Perfect, perfect cover by Pappas.
He did amazing. He's a fucking veteran of the goddamn pro of the FBI, though.
So Bodie's like, let me explain these guys to you. We surf Nazis.
Yeah.
They live for the radical, much like I do, Griff. They live for the radical. They do not, they're into some real illegal shit. But they don't get the spiritual side of surfing, which is why I don't talk to these people. So he's like, oh, and by the way, I'm throwing a little soiree tonight. Would you like to come by?
Soiree.
You can just feel the fucking electricity between these guys.
Aabra, you're a lot closer to surfers. Do you ever go to a surfer party if they invite you?
I think I would go. They like to set things on fire. You know, there's a lot of fires in their scenes, and I think that'd be kind of fun.
That one character is constantly, like, putting his foot in the fire. Like, what was that about? Like, he was, like, the crazy... He was the one crazy... I think his name was Rosie. He was the one crazy one.
Rosie.
What you get... By the way, people, every group of friends, you need the one guy who could kill somebody. So this lets you know that. You want that one guy. So Utah's like... Maybe I can show up. I don't know. I got stuff to do, but, you know, I could probably swing by. And they're like, all right, it's a date. But first, our boys, who is it? Is it Pappas and Utah follow the surf Nazis?
I thought just Utah followed them, but it might have been.
Yeah, they're part of like a day shift that keeps an eye on the surf Nazis, yeah.
Yeah.
And the surf Nazis, they're not using their turn indicators. They're not, you know, they're... You're just going crazy on the row, weaving in and out.
Right.
Which is what everybody does in fucking California traffic.
They have a Jeep, too. And so they're, like, standing outside the Jeep. Murray, you probably noticed what music they were playing. What music were they playing?
I don't remember it at all. What were they playing?
Oh, shit, man.
Were they playing the Red Hot Chili Peppers?
They were playing Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Party on Your Pussy?
That's right. Party on Your Pussy.
That's actually Chili Peppers.
No, it is.
Which is so funny because they're such boring mom rock now. And it's like, no, these guys were, like, talking about fucking all the time.
Constantly.
And now it's this... Like one boring song about California after the other. What happened to these guys?
Dream of California.
They got off drugs, Griff. They forgot. They're not in the radical anymore. They got into the spiritual side of surfing. That's what happened to them.
They don't even perform naked with socks on their cocks.
No, they don't.
Except Flea. Flea still does that. But that's a...
Well, glad somebody's keeping...
keeping the sock.
But yeah, I'm so annoyed that Johnny Utah violated Scooby-Doo villain... Rule number one, that the most helpful person, the person that says, hey, watch out for those guys, that's the villain.
Right.
And he's like, you know, oh, Bodhi's telling me to watch out for these surf Nazis. They must be the bad guys. Idiot.
Question.
He is in the cock smog.
Right? Oh, my God.
He's inhaling it.
If Pappas were the one in Johnny's role here, do you think he smells a, you know, like a projection here?
Oh,
because Pappas is our like multi-year veteran, like 2-decade veteran of the FBI. Do you think if he were undercover,
he's a little
surfer,
older and wiser?
Yeah. Do you think if Bodhi tried to tell him, yeah, those guys are bad news into illegal stuff, he'd be like, oh yeah, I see what you're doing here, or would he just be like, these fucking cool kids think I'm cool? Go full.
It's true. Yeah, a huge character arc if Johnny Utah even has character, that my friend Carrie pointed out, is that he hasn't really been tested in the field. She kept using the phrase, like, he obviously has never shot a live round. And she used it very clinical. She sounded like Jack Baudelaire. It was actually kind of terrifying because, again, her dad was a cop. But he's clearly never killed anybody. He's very inexperienced.
Very
and
green.
A lot of this, yeah, and so a lot of this movie is, if there is a character arc on Johnny Utah, of him, you know, coming into his own and find out who he is, like when he's carrying the surfboard into work, which is hilarious. And yeah, getting ready for the test, the ultimate test as a field agent.
He's young, he's dumb, and he is full of cum.
Goddamn right he is.
Yeah, right.
He's got a massive case of fucking blue balls. That's all I'm saying.
And we're cutting to, we're learning about all the rap
They follow them. They get this. Now they know where the surf Nazis live. They're the crash pad.
We go to sexy intel lady.
Yeah.
She got the whole rap sheet on them. She doesn't pull up the fucking printouts of their fucking turn ons and turn offs. We just look at the rap sheet. And it turns
out. I'd love to know what Warchild's turn ons are.
I want to know that too. This world. I like.
By the way, what kind of surf Nazis are there? Because I'm sorry, Warchild's not white, all right? So they're like, is the Nazis even got, has this fucking diversification even gotten to the Nazis now, bro? I'm sick of this woke shit. I'm sorry if I gotta take the show down a minute. All right. I guess
the remake that Tim will greenlight will be called Surf Proud Boys Must Die.
There surf we go. Nazis Must Live is there what we I go. Call it. Well, yeah.
Surf
but I'm glad they're like, hey, you know, normally our whole philosophy is against you, but you're a big guy. Come join us.
Right? So, yeah. You're big enough, strong enough. It's like prison, man. Yeah. You just get in there and you throw your dick around and you're the big guy now.
So, yeah, they go on the rap sheet, and it's just like, these guys have to be the ex-presidents.
They dealt a little cocaine. They have to be the ex-presidents. There's nowhere where it's like they have a lot of money. If you're selling cocaine, you're probably not robbing banks, too. But, yeah, they're like, these are clearly our guys. They have a bad guy's rap. We're gonna
these
get
are
them.
The guys, bro, because remember, he's not seasoned.
Right. So we cut over to the surf
stakeout.
Nazi's house.
They're doing a stakeout.
They're doing a stakeout. They're just hanging out there, and they're tagging in our two goof cops, FBI agents, that we've been seeing. They've been mocking Pappas the whole movie and everything. They're getting tagged in for the night shift, and Pappas is so fucking happy to gloat over them. Hands them off a cold pizza.
Disgust. Cold Domino's pizza.
Cold Domino's, straight out of?
Detroit.
And, no, actually, I think it started in Ypsilanti, Michigan.
It did.
Which is the little brother to Ann Arbor, Michigan.
Yes.
Aabra, just so you know.
It's where the poor people okay. in that area live.
Ypsilanti's a very cool place.
But, yeah, Matt nicknamed these two FBI agents Rosencrantz and Guildenstern and wanted them to die so bad.
Oh, they suck so bad. I would have loved
it. You just got a pop from Matt Soce so badly. That fucking Shakespeare reference.
Oh, okay.
Boing.
So,
all right.
Yeah, so so he's like, I got a place to be, bro. He's like looking in the rear view, making sure his hair looks perfect for Bodie and shit. Maybe he's, I think he had some like shells like braided into his hair. I don't know.
He did try to doll himself up. You're right. He put okay. on a yeah, little bit of guyliner to make his eye pop.
Yeah, just a kiss of perfume right around the neck.
Right. No, he just sprayed in the air and walked in.
Yes,
right.
Yes.
And he's like, I'm ready, bro. So. So we go to Bodie's rocking party.
Of course, this is Aubrey's favorite party she's ever been to. Right. Could you tell us a little bit about this party?
I'm assuming these are just Anthony Kiedis's like entourage hanging around in a gorgeous what is that, like a little arts and crafts or something, these little beach houses, and they've got what, fire breathing and attention whoring and terrible dancing, very white.
Oh,
this
my
party.
God.
And just some terrible music.
Was this where they were playing Jimi Hendrix, weren't they? I don't remember.
Oh, okay, Jimi Hendrix is good. But.
Yeah, Jimi Hendrix is like the only song where it's like they actually paid for it. Everything else sounds like it's just off key of another song, you know?
Yeah, it looks like Woodstock 99 or that terrible, what was that MTV show that was at the beach?
Oh.
And
shit,
it was just like all the Aryan youth on camera. It was just all blondes.
Have you ever seen...
You point out something nice. The surf Nazis are the most diverse group of people.
Yes.
And yet the quote-unquote good guys
yes.
are all blonde-haired, blue-eyed Nazis.
Yeah.
Anthony Kiedis, like our beloved Matt, I can't remember his name from Samurai Cop, proudly Greek-American. He's like, I ain't white. And Warchild, he's... I don't know what he is other than like godlike. Yeah. They're the most diverse group. Yeah. But anyway, yeah, this party is just white attention whore. These people would love Instagram. These people would love TikTok.
These are the kind of people, you said, they're rich, so they can spend their life finding themselves. They can travel and follow a band. They're at Coachella.
Bodie would be like Bear's Grill or the Liver King guy. He's like the combination of the two.
And that's why they're so enamored with him, because they're these vanilla white folk
right.
who have never seen anything.
They probably came from, you know, money and everything.
Right.
So they're like, oh, now we're D-class, bro. We're burning everything in the... Like Aubrey said, they're just burning everything they can get their hands on.
This reminds me.
Oh,
I know
boy.
A girl. You remember Imani Toomer, the football player?
Yeah, I do.
Who played at Michigan.
Michigan.
She was married to him. This was a sister of one of my My sister's friend's sister was married to this guy, okay? So all she did, because she didn't have to work, is she's married to a millionaire. So she would, like, go to Thailand to some retreat to find herself. That was, like, basically her life. This is these people.
Yeah.
Exactly. Trust fund bastards.
Trust fund bastards. Shit, I forget what they call it, but slum venturers or something like that.
Eat, pray, love type people.
Where it's just like...
Because we can all do that, right? We can just say, I'm going to take a year off and just find myself.
It's just like the fun and being like, oh, I walked a mile in their feet. I went to their villages.
Yeah, they served
everything.
Me, and you know, I learned a lot about them. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, California is lousy with these rich bitches. Charles Manson would recruit very specific type of women into his circle, including our beloved Murder, She Wrote, Jessica Fletcher, whatever the actress's name is. I can't remember. Angela Lansbury's daughter.
Oh,
wow,
Angela
Lansbury's
daughter.
Okay. Wow.
Yeah.
Well, when you come up with everything just given to you, I suppose you probably
you're
would
naive.
Be. Yeah,
you're
naive.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. Yeah.
Did you ever hear of Brother 12? I don't want to make this a thing, but was that a West Coast thing?
Ooh, what's that?
Okay, I just learned about that one. I think it was another West Coast thing. I would say look into it because I don't know enough details to weigh this episode.
Oh, this looks nasty. Yeah, I will.
Yeah. Okay.
These are just the kind of people who take Jim Morrison seriously. That's what we're dealing with.
Yes, exactly. Johnny Utah is, like you guys said, he's in the Cogsmog, and he thinks he's made a new friend or someone who's going to help him kick out the surf Nazis. He doesn't realize he's being recruited into a cult with, you know, an actual cult, a death cult.
100%. Yeah. And, like... We're getting into the whole dynamics of relationships and everything in a little bit here. It's going to be amazing fucking cuckoo. The back half of this episode is probably the best back half we've ever gone through.
Well, yeah, I mean, it makes sense because Johnny's kind of lost his identity. He was the man at one time.
Exactly.
And then that knee injury, he's nothing.
Right. He should be a quarterback, you know, leading a football team right now. He should. Who was big in the early 90s? He should be Troy Aikman.
Yes.
But yes.
So the cool people of the group, which is the Bodie and the Brodies, go out to the beach and they set up a big bonfire, and this is where they start having a wave measuring contest.
Oh,
where
they're
basically like, I rode a 20-foot wave one time.
It's better than sex, bro. Oh.
And you hear all that shit that you hear every like 20-year-old guy say, I'm not gonna live to be 30, bro, and all this horse shit.
Live fast, die young.
Leave a beautiful corpse.
Leave a beautiful
corpse.
All that
shit.
All that bullshit.
All that nauseating shit. And thankfully, Tyler is our surrogate. That's like, I'm out of here. I can't take this shit anymore.
You see, you guys talked about this while I was taking a whiz. Tyler, you remember our first scene where we met Tyler, where she was upset about a young surfer trying to learn the craft. And she's like, get off my beach, bro. She is a gatekeeper, and suddenly she's like, oh, I hate these people gatekeeping surfing and making it all about... I don't like Tyler in this moment at all.
I don't know if I like any of the characters in this movie.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, she is tricky because she's kind of a maverick. She's
naked lady.
Yeah, she obviously truly loves surfing, and she must have been a puzzle to write. I wonder if they did the old technique, like the lead in Alien, they just wrote as a man and then gender swapped it at the last minute.
Well, yeah, she was clearly put in by the studio because they're like, whoa, this movie is getting too gay. Throw a woman in there.
Yeah. And we haven't had a movie like this since Commando. It's a little too gay.
Right. Yeah. So, yeah, and then this is where we hear the ancient folklore, the 50-year storm. Once every 50 years,
bro.
A giant wave comes down from the Arctic and the jet stream, El Nino, all this shit. Comes together to form the most perfect wave, and Bodie's been chasing that his entire life.
The most tubular tube,
and everyone's like, "I heard it was just like a shamanistic tale." I'm like, no, it's real, bro, and I'm gonna ride that wave.
So
foreshadow,
yeah, little foreshadow. Tyler's gonna head inside. Where I mean, come on, Aubrey, you can describe all the fucking great artwork Bodie has in his house here.
Yeah, Bodie's got this amazing little party house just covered in candles. They really seem to want to set everything on fire, and the walls are covered in their surfboards, of course, conveniently a spare one for Johnny Utah in a minute, and just like the tackiest photos that I assume were just from the shoot.
Right.
Like yeah, it's just of this pictures movie. Of them being extreme with three axes. Yeah. They're yeah. you know, oh, yeah. skydiving.
Yeah.
They're
yeah, it's just know. A guy trying too hard. It's like the guy who holds up the fish on OK Cupid. You ever seen no. this? These pictures of yeah. guys like they pose with a fish or on top of a mountain, like look how hard I go.
That's the Tinder joke now. Because Tinder's like the OK Cupid now.
Oh, okay. So,
but yeah, no, you're dead on. You got it right. You just got the wrong application.
Okay.
So no, that's still the thing.
So yeah, so Tyler looks into Johnny's vacant eyes, and she's just like, "I'm worried about you, Johnny. You have that kamikaze look."
Ooh.
Because Bodhi eats that kind of shit up. He loves that.
And that's when Brody interrupts because they go deep into each other's eyes. I mean, both their eyes are just vacant.
Reading
ocean.
Eyes like a
yeah.
motherfucker.
They're just going years and fucking years into each other's eyes. And Bodhi comes in, breaks it up. This is where Brody escaped. I see it in the notes there. Brody. Utah has his own demons.
So
yeah, and this actually shows that Tyler is a great character because I mean for this terrible movie is yeah. because she obviously did not fall for Bodhi's bullshit and he must be furious about it. No,
oh, yeah.
no gay. Am I that loud?
No.
Oh, Matt's pantomime. I mean, I don't know. Oh, he's saying it's a low bar. I thought he was telling me to keep it down. Oh. Bitch, I'm loud. But yeah, so Tyler never. Quite fell for his stuff, and like he had her body, but he never had her mind.
Right.
Yeah, we get quite a few more lines about Tyler and Bodhi's connection later in the movie too. So you could tell that Bodhi really, I like that. I never really put my thumb on that one in this movie. Is that Bodhi really is bothered as a narcissist would be right. that he didn't get this girl completely wrapped around him.
Right. Like she's like over him.
Yeah.
You know.
Like, he comes in, smooches on her, and she's like, yeah, whatever.
So...
Exactly.
So now, I think this is where Bodhi is going to test our man Johnny. He's like, hey, stealth mission. What's that? We can go surfing in the middle of the night.
That's right. It's dope. Badass.
So they grab the boards. Even Tyler goes for that. Even though she was getting sick of the macho shit. She's like, hey, tasty waves. I got to ride them.
That's right.
So we get a nice night surfing scene, which was actually filmed during the day. They just put a filter on it.
Oh, that's
apparently
right.
You can see shadows and shit.
You can see the sun glinting off their hair.
Yeah.
I was so creeped out by these shots, and I'm glad I know why now. Thank you.
Well, hey, I gotta give it up to Swayze. He does a lot of his own stunts in this movie, you know, so that's cool. I mean, because I think he does some of the skydiving for real later on.
That's yeah. definitely him skydiving, yeah.
So, so they're doing their night surfing. What happens?
Well, this is where, you know, Johnny, you know, Bodhi is egging Johnny on. Get in there, bro. You could definitely do it. I just learned how to surf like 2 days ago.
Which is what a narcissist does. You find somebody who's not...
You.
Yeah, builds people up.
Yeah.
So they fall in love with you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so all those encouraging words and everything, Johnny's just getting praised on. He left his home life years ago, so he hasn't been praised like this in so long. He just had harping on him. So it's like... All this praise is elevating him so fucking far into the stratosphere.
Well, you can't believe someone as cool as Bodhi is saying this.
That as well.
Yes, yes, yes. My friend Carrie said he's looking for his spiritual daddy.
Yup.
Yes. And Bodhi is there. He's like, I'm
Does
here
the
for
spiritual
you.
Daddy have to also, you know, fuck you? Or can it just... Can it no. go both ways, or
he
what?
It doesn't have to be sexual, no.
Okay.
If we're getting into how cults work, yes.
It's got to be a little of both.
Yeah, Charlie Manson, if he couldn't talk a girl into blowing him, the first time he met her, out.
Okay. That's how a lot of these cults work, from what I've heard, is that it's usually led by a man who's like, yeah, I gotta get my dick wet in this this whole system here. Okay.
Yeah, there's an incredible doco on the Source family you should try if you're into weird stuff. And he has like 17 wives at one point in the story.
Jesus.
So the bros head out. It's just Tyler and Johnny out in the water. And she's like, you're always so serious all the time, but it looks like you're finally like mellowing out and having fun.
And that bright moonlight, she can tell his face. I don't know. Maybe she blind man grabbed at it and felt it and was like, that's a smile.
So he's got all this pent up sexual energy for Brody or Bodie, and he's got to let it out. And Tyler, you're there.
Yeah.
So we get I felt kind of gypped. Like, where's the love scene? We didn't get it. They just went cut to the next morning.
This is what Brokeback Mountain could have been.
Sweetzin is like, what the hell?
Sweetzin is like, what the hell?
We didn't even get any fuckable music, let alone any fucking.
Yeah, Laura Petty was more sexual with that creepy kangaroo dude in Tank Girl. So we know it wasn't her.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a good point. Keanu.
She was more sexual than Madonna in A League of Her Own.
Oh, hell yeah.
And Rosie O'Donnell.
Yeah, I figure Bigelow's like, I don't want to see that. Nah.
I haven't seen it.
Yes, Catherine Bigelow is totally enmeshed in the homoeroticism. She's like, that will kill it. No. Just going to have guy-on-guy action.
This is the original Brokeback Mountain. She recognized.
This inspired the guy who wrote Brokeback Mountain.
Yeah. Your serious demeanor is gone.
Point Break, looks like Broke Back.
Oh, that's the... Okay. All right, so they go back up to shore and they fuck by the fireside. At least that's what we're left to believe because the camera pans away.
I was getting some Massacre at Central High vibes off there.
Yes.
There's a lot of beach fucking in there.
There's a lot of beach fucking. And when you fuck on the beach, you got...
A lot of sand.
A lot of sand.
Yeah, it's not good.
Don't
fuck on the beach, people.
Next morning, Johnny Utah wakes up, realizes I'm late for my own... Okay, so he says, I'm late for work. I'm late for work. You know what his job is this morning? Aabra, tell us these beans. Spill these beans for us. What is his job?
It's the raid on the surf Nazis that he arranged. You had one job, Johnny.
So don't...
Aabra.
Okay.
Do not tell me...
Can we throw a foghorn in right this moment?
Really it's pretty good.
He is just...
Idiot.
He's blind. He just can't see. It's just fog everywhere.
That was good enough distraction.
And he's got to let it out. So he just starts kissing on Tyler some more. He's just so giddy. Because he thinks he's finally got an in with Bodie. He doesn't even care about his job anymore. All his life is about surfing and Bodie.
Exactly. The spiritual awakening of Johnny Utah realizing he doesn't, you know, he wasn't going to make it as quarterback. He's not an FBI agent. He's this spiritual whatever. Yeah.
Oh, and he's not hetero.
He's a disciple.
And yeah, well, that's the other spiritual awakening, isn't it? But, yeah. Yeah, so he's late for his own raid. Ridiculous. Yeah.
Yes. I just love this, too, because we're always hearing about how justice moves so slow. It took them one day. One fucking day to get a raid arranged on these people.
Yeah, they get a warrant. Yeah, he even mentions that.
And you know why? You know why Fender was in this group? To act as the POC that they could say, hey.
Yes. We got probable cause. Is there a non-white guy in this group? Yeah, that's a good probable cause. Judge just signed off on it.
Immediately. Oh.
LA in 1991, that was probably true.
Yes, 100%. So?
So they're like, we got Pops. Where you been, man? He's still jumping on him. He's still got a meat fucking. The budget on meatball sandwiches is through the roof.
He's at the corner of the block, by the way, Pappas is, right. Because he's getting wired up for the secret mission.
Right.
So he's just talking to Johnny
he's
through
hit
a radio.
The front. He wants Johnny to hit the back. Because remember, There's a possibility that this is all bullshit. So he's got to maintain his cover.
Right.
So it's like, you just come in if we need you. You just watch the back. If anyone leaves, you catch them.
You gotta, if you really want to enjoy this film, the continuity, like there's not really a much character development, but there's a tank top, aka wife beater continuity here. Because if you look at Gary Busey's wife beater tank top in this movie, meatball stains always progressing throughout the movie. It's incredible.
It's like the meatball patterns, like the sweat patterns.
Yes.
Do you think it was someone's job every day to take a Polaroid photo of his meatball stains? And
I mean, I just think it was straight up Gary Busey going method, and that's why I'm shipping him, as the kids would say, throughout this movie.
So, Pappas, he's going to go to the front door, make up a lost dog story to get in. Everyone's going to surround the house, Johnny in the back. So he's like, Scooby! Scooby, where are you? Like, yeah. Great cover. Goes to the house. It's answered by a young lady. I think she was just wearing a G-string.
She was wearing, yep, and like a bikini top.
Remember, it's 90s, so the ass was kind of flat, but it's 90s ass.
It's very long back.
She's talking in the bedroom, and he's like having a seizure on his bed. I don't, he's supposed to be like rocking out to his headphones.
He's drumming with his headphones, yeah.
He had no idea they were filming him.
Yeah, I bet that's what it was.
My favorite character, naked violent woman, taking a shower.
Because we got Johnny's shot of him looking in, yeah, and he sees naked woman, and the camera lingers on her.
Right. Another studio, like, you know, they wrote that in. Like
let's let the fans have it. We're almost at the halfway mark. We need to get them excited again.
Right. And then Gary Busey's like, she's like, get the fuck out of here. I don't know anything about a dog. Well, you know, can I just check it out? And then so something tips off the like war child, right?
I don't. Oh, well, somebody comes back and says, somebody's at the door. And they start just freaking out immediately and unloading
the guns immediately. Like, no, look, what's wrong?
Yeah.
They've got the Kickboxer 3 duffel bag full of guns.
Yes. It wasn't that they suspected it was a government agent or anything. They suspected anybody knocking at their door. And so they take it to the 10th level. And of course,
also they're probably they're high on their own supply. They've probably been smoking snorting coke all day long.
Yeah.
So that's they're true. Super paranoid.
That's true. Mm-hmm. Or P2P.
Right.
That was very prevalent at this time. Yes.
So War Child just pulls out the duffel bag of weapons.
Right.
Tells everybody to get one.
Johnny's watching this in his little dentist mirror, by the way. And so he's radioing into the other goofs that we've been seeing throughout this movie. You got to tell him to get out of there. Don't flash his badge.
But somebody's mowing their lawn right at the same time.
It was a motorized electric mower, from
very,
what I could tell?
Very odd mower, because it was like a 1950s manual, yes, push one with a motor on it.
Yes.
I've never seen that. So that was interesting.
That might be something you see in Portland. But you don't.
I've never seen anything like that. And it's like apparently the loudest mower on earth, because all the idiot FBI are like, I can't hear, I can't. Doesn't occur to them just to go talk to the very nice guy and just say, hey, could you just not?
Nothing.
Yeah.
Nothing. Yeah. Very serious life and death situation. No, let's not do that. But that's the FBI in a nutshell for you.
So Johnny, being the hero he is, like, I got to go in. So he's like,
that's far too much emotion.
That is a lot of emotion.
That sets a Pappas hears that, so he just barges in, pushes past G-string lady. One of the goons just grabs G-string lady as a shield,
body shield.
And did she get shot up?
I swear to fucking God, Aabra, you confirmed this for me. She gets shot the fuck up here.
Yeah, the first one, the first shot, and I don't know what's going on with the edit on this. It looks like Johnny Utah almost uses her as a human shield, and it looks at first like they both get it, but then later we see her in the hallway, and then she's being used as a human shield, or a hostage, I guess, at that situation.
Yes. Yeah, that's what I saw. I saw her get shot up, yeah, and then a minute later, she's back in there being used as a human shield.
Maybe there's just a ton of hot ladies in this house.
And they all wear the same outfit. There's, yeah, a uniform.
Yeah.
Because we all know that these cliques walk in uniform. That makes sense.
Meanwhile, hot, violent, naked woman still taking that shower.
Well, that shower is also...
She just had sex with Anthony Kiedis, so it makes sense that she'd be...
You know. Scrub it off.
The shower's as loud as the fucking lawnmower. So she's just like, wait, is something going on? Is someone making Rice Krispies with cold milk?
Yeah.
So Johnny Utah finally like breaks in the back door, and he's doing something or other. No one knows what he's doing until he tries to get into the bathroom for cover.
Right. Somebody shoots Kiedis in the foot, too.
Kiedis shoots himself in the foot.
Oh, he shoots himself in the foot.
Yeah. He would.
Perfect cast.
That was so satisfying.
That was
a gif of that.
Yeah. I can make you a gif of
that. And this is where Johnny bumps into the biggest heel of this fucking movie. violent naked woman who just thrashes the fuck out. Some guys had to pay a lot of money to get this treatment, but Johnny gets it for free, and she's dishing it out. She just fucks Johnny up.
So now we're finally getting down to the meat of the matter. War Child, of course, who's they're after, who they are after, because he's the main, you know, hench here. Hench, main macho man here. Runs
he looks
out
like Super Macho Man from the Punch Out game.
Yes, he does. Yeah. Runs out the door. Utah's chasing after him, tackles him right by that fucking motorized manual lawnmower.
I'm glad you said tackle. He's going, his instincts are kicking in.
That's right. And so they're tussling on the ground as
he's got a Rambo knife, War Child.
Yes. And so he's bringing it down on Johnny. Johnny managed to knock it away. But
no,
then
Johnny puts it into the lawnmower. So it flicks out.
And so now they're tussling for who's on top.
Guys, I want to point out, this is why we have that lever on lawnmowers now.
Yeah, the handle.
Back in the day, they
to kill the blades.
It's because of this movie.
Yeah. And so the blades are just running. The person's abandoned his lawnmower, and now they're shoving each other's faces into it, and Utah's just about to get it when Pappas comes around the corner and shoots the motor dead.
Right.
And the blades instantly stop.
Yes. And then
it has wheels. Just push it away.
Whoa,
anything.
That's logical. We can't.
Anything. The tension in this is non-existent. We're all still coming back. Yeah. We're all still coming back down from Hot Naked. What's her name?
Violent Naked Woman.
So it's like this action means nothing to us at this point. And we're going to learn these aren't our guys.
No. And we learn from Detroit's own Tom Sizemore in an uncredited scene because he was a nobody at this time. And he's a DEA agent. And he's like, what the fuck? I've been working these idiots for 6 months. I fucking frosted my hair. You think I want hair like this? You fucking idiots. And it's like, oh, they were supposed to be bank robbery this day. Well, they were in fucking Santa Cruz doing some shit.
What?
But I was sure it was them. Bodie wouldn't push me into a, you know, the wrong thinking. No, he's just confused.
Any other things we might have missed before we head down to the real beach realization here, Aabra?
No, I got it.
Okay. So here we go. We're going down to the beach. And he's just trying to figure it out. He's like, what the fuck happened? We had it. These guys are fucking surfer Nazis. Everything added up. And then he sees somebody's ass glistening in the sun.
And we've seen that ass before. And we've seen those tan lines before. Yes, people. The whole mystery hinges on a guy's ass.
And somebody says, you're as white as a ghost, bro. And then he flashes back to Papa's telling him, forget about it, kid. They're ghosts.
God, it's so awful.
That was literally the connection he made. That's how they did it.
Yes.
And so then Tyler, to carry the bit along further, goes, you look like you've seen a ghost. I hate this movie so much. I wish I was joking.
I wish at this point Johnny Utah's mind was just that clip from Futurama where he's going, ass, 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 ass.
Yes. Yes, please.
So, like, Johnny's like, I got diarrhea. I got to go. So he just takes off so
That's
he
right.
can follow Bodie and his crew.
And before we cut to what he's learned, we're cutting this episode, everybody. We've had you for so long. We've taken such a wonderful
take
journey.
Take a pee break. A 24, I mean, I don't know. We're going to give you a few days to absorb this.
It'd be like a 72-hour pee break. And so then we'll be back with you. Did we keep it warm during this pee break, Murray?
Oh, God.
Keep it lukewarm.
Keep it lukewarm, everybody.
And tune in the next couple days when we finish the second part of this Point Break episode.